folks say that grown-up men are still just little boys. That really the only difference is the price of our toys. We go for macho symbols like guns and running shoes. Pickup trucks, hunting ducks, and power tools, power tools.
Well, good Saturday morning to you. If you haven't been outside, it's a little touch of fall. It's kind of cool. I put on blue jeans this morning. I'm not going to wear shorts in here. It's always cold. And beautiful day.
I love it.
Oh, I can't complain. It'd be a great day to go to the state fair. My name's Denny Smith. This is the Home and Garden Show. We're brought to you by the Michalis Corporation. Water storms, fire, and wet basements. Life happens. Michalis happens to help you through it. It's 844-FIX-INDY. If you need them, they really do come a-running. In studio today, that was the voice of Hall of Fame broadcaster Terry Stacey. Allison Lemons is here. Good morning, Allison. Are you awake and ready to go?
I am. Yeah. I was going over my script for Into the Weeds.
Yes. A little bit different on Into the Weeds.
I should look at my script, too.
Yeah, and then Jack Phipps from Allisonville Home and Garden by Sullivan. Jack, glad you're back.
Good morning, everybody. Yeah, glad to be back.
Hi, Jack.
You know, I'm going to...
Hi, Terry.
Thanks for coming back.
I'm going to get used
Jack.
To
Thanks
Jack.
Thanks for having
yeah,
me.
Jack.
There's a whole rhyme.
Yeah, here we go.
Thanks for coming back, Jack.
You're just so much more pleasant.
Nothing, than matter nothing fact. You don't lack.
Pat's personality.
Pat, that's a matter
like
of fact.
I think I bring a yeah.
Daddy Mac
feeling to the show.
Wait a minute. We're playing the rhyming game with these two ladies right now.
I can't stop.
Don't forget stack, rack, sack. You know, there's lots
oh,
of others.
You go there.
You go
lack.
There.
Oh, boy.
Okay. Well, Terry Lynn, what's new at the fair? My goodness, what
yeah,
good weather today.
You guys were out... For the first day, Sunday. How
oh
was that?
Oh, my gosh.
The
it was so fun.
Bar.
Look at me from head to toe.
Dairy.
I have on a new hat.
Support your local farmer. Very cute hat.
Yep. Thank you to our friends there at the Indiana State Fair. Honestly, they're just...
Brooke really took
Anna Welchel. Yeah. You are magnificent as far as public relations and communications. And then, of course, our friends at American Dairy. You know, just we love you. We're so grateful every time we get to come out.
I see you're wearing the
one-of-a-kind
shirt. That's
yeah.
only given
shirt.
To people who are
And I'm yep. very jealous of that shirt.
I don't blame you because I was jealous of who had it. And we told her how much we loved it and Brooke Williams. And she said, I'll be back.
Oh, so you
and
got a
did.
Special treatment.
Jack.
Well, then the lady from the state fair brought you this
you
hat.
Stop.
She stole it off a kid's head. It's a youth size hat.
It's a youth size hat.
She stole it off some kid. I go,
it fits pretty well.
Terry,
listen, this is the key. I've learned. She said, listen, it's what you want. As a female with a different kind of head, she said, you need to get the youth. When you get the youth hat, then this from top to bottom, the part that sits above your ears, isn't as long.
Are you saying that men have fat heads?
I'm saying that I think you're from your top
like.
Of your head
like.
To your ear is might be a little bit longer.
So the instead of from here,
not
from
you,
your forehead
you have
to your eye.
A small. Yeah. Medium-sized head. But I think most men...
She's backing up, folks. All right. Dig yourself out of that hole. Go on.
I'm done.
You're
had a great time at the fair. The weather has been beautiful these last few days, and it's going to continue, I think. But this is the second weekend. You get two more, this one and next one, next week, and
this
then it's
will
done.
Be, this will be a honey. This
just
is
like the Olympics,
Chamber
over and done.
Weekend, just like that. Did you happen to watch... on the Facebook live when Hammer and his son went after the
no,
deep fried Oreos.
I didn't.
I felt so sorry for Chris. What the challenge was, they gave him four deep fried Oreos.
This was yesterday.
And the first one to take him down was the winner. Well, it was a father and son event, and they were talking smack with each other. I mean, it was getting down. But the difference was Hammer had a beer right there, a tall beer. And so he was dumping these deep-fried Oreos into his beer to soften them, just like Joey Chestnut would.
Yeah.
And he was hammering them down. Poor Chris was over there choking. I mean, he didn't have any saliva to get anything chewing. But his
dad... Yeah, it was not... It was unfair.
His dad
whooped him
good.
Unfair. Don't you think, Allison, you were there?
Yeah, I think it was fair.
Really?
Deep-fried
Chris
Oreo.
Didn't really seem really...
Oh, did he not seem like he was really into it?
Yeah. Yeah, he was just, it's like he was grazing. I was like, come on, pick up the pace, Chris.
Is that a dry bite of fried Oreo?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And maybe he was just trying a different technique, but it didn't work. But that's all right. He can train for next year.
Well, you don't want to choke. Something like that. I've been in a lot of food competitions,
yeah.
And something like that, you could easily choke.
And people
if you
forget.
You do it really, really, really well.
Hammer has been on a diet for the last year, so he's hungry.
He's hungry.
So he was
hangry,
ready.
He wanted
hungry.
That Oreo.
He wanted them.
Well, we've got a fun show. We got a fun show for you today. We're going to have Mike Hawkins in from Michaela's, and we're going to talk about different things. Today, we're talking about different things. Today, we're going to talk about roofing, gutters, and siding. Now, doesn't that sound exciting for professionals?
It
does. But not to be outdone, we're also going to talk about flooring. And I have been trying to track down somebody for flooring, and got some help here at the station. We got two lovely ladies coming in, Kim and Kelly Marburger. Now, these guys are fourth and fifth generation. I don't know which one. Lots of generations of the E.F. Marburger Company that does flooring. Right there. It's your next door neighbor there, Jeff.
Yeah, right down the street.
Interesting address. 9999 Allisonville Road. So I suppose.
The stallion in front.
The stallion out front. I want to hear the story of that stallion, too.
The literal statue of a stallion up front.
I got a really interesting email from David Wood that was forwarded on to us. It's about roofing and stuff. And so getting Michael Hawkins to talk about Michael Hawkins. Hawkins makes him sound like a physicist, doesn't it? He's going to come in and help us sort of coach through this. But you always feel like you're at risk anytime you call in a professional. So where do you go? You go to the big box stores. No. Not that the big box stores aren't helpful for a lot of things. Stay local. Stay with the people that in the family businesses that can really help you out of a jam are going to be there 24/7. So that's what the whole focus of things is. And Jack, first question for you.
Yes.
The ground ivy, the creeping Charlie, is going absolutely nuts right now. And somebody was telling me that the best chemical is something triclopyr, whatever it is.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure I really understand ground ivy other than it's the nastiest weed in the world.
And it can spread like crazy.
Yeah.
I know a lot of people go out and try to pull it. You know, all that's going to do is make it come back tenfold.
You know, of all the places that I have ground ivy, it's around the septic tank heads. And I'm thinking, is there something around this? But it just totally, it's like hundreds of feet of this.
Yeah, it seems like any bare dirt, you know, if it doesn't have crabgrass, it's going to get that ground ivy.
God bless.
And
them.
It'll spread.
It's sort of green.
Can I show you? So my husband, David, took a picture of this. And said, what is that? Is that what that is?
If it looks like a lamb's
That looks like the wild violet.
What? That sounds like something you don't want to kill.
Oh, no. Both of them are terrible. They're hard to kill.
Well, I get
that's bad because it mounds. This is bad because it spreads.
So you would kill this?
I would.
Oh, yeah.
What would you kill it with? Something like hot oil? something like that. Something organic.
Vinegar.
So if you have one of those little weed poppers.
Thank you, Allison.
Allison is always Johnny on the spot.
Vinegar's
she
good.
Knows her weeds.
A lawn weed killer that won't kill the grass but will kill the weed.
Okay.
I gave Jack a book that was given to us when I went through that Master Gardener program, which, by the way, if you've ever wanted to do that, you go on the Purdue website, sign up. There are a lot of them are virtual now. But if you've ever wanted to learn about everything, it is really, really interesting. It's a 13, 14-week course. There is a final, but nobody's ever flunked the final, if that gives you any confidence. And you really do learn a lot. You don't learn enough to know everything, but you learn enough to know what you don't know, which is the most important
And it's
part.
Cool you learn indie-specific things. So
exactly.
They're all going to be backyard, you know, in your backyard, very relevant.
That always works. And we're here to take your phone calls, too. It's 317-239-9393. Jack Phipps, Terry Stacy, Allison Lemons. Over on the board, the magnificent one, Landon Coons. Hey, Landon, how are you?
Can't complain.
Yeah.
Went about 5 hours of sleep.
You know what?
Not too bad.
I can't imagine being out until 1 o'clock and then waiting for the alarm to go off at 5 or 6. Are you crazy?
A little bit.
Yeah.
He's young. There's a difference.
Yeah, there.
He is young. True. It's going to catch up with you, though, pal.
Oh, I know. I heard what's the one thing that everybody says? Like, once you hit your 30s, like, it hits you like a hot shovel or something like that.
Hits you like a hot
I'm
shovel.
I'm not there
like
yet.
A hot shovel.
You got at least a 32.
I don't know. I've heard hot shovel. I heard everything sucks when you get in your 30s.
Great.
Wow.
Sorry, Allison.
You got that to look forward to, kids.
Oh, no.
239-9393. We'll take your questions, whether it's about the house, whether it's about the yard. Lots going on in the yards. We're going to cover some things today for you. The yard, the garden, the home. I've been given the haircut. I'm doing the Pat Sullivan shear test on ivy and anything is just pissing me off around the house. I'm cutting it off with the scissors. And I, you know, those plants look at me like, really? You're gonna cut off
everything,
my blooms?
You're
this
gonna
time
do that
of year,
right now?
Yeah, I don't. This time of year, I start to get a little, you know. not weepy, but, you know, things start to change a little bit. Yeah. You know, kids are now back in school. Everything's starting to look all scraggly.
Kind of tired from the summer.
Kind of tired. And I just don't like it because we still have, what, another month and a half of summer?
Oh, yeah.
But it starts to feel like early fall.
And then we'll get the Indian summer, and then we get the whoom, and it comes in. You hear what that whoom?
I don't know. Is that coming from the north?
That's from the north. Yeah.
Sounds like you need to be tested for it.
Maybe so.
Hey, Big Dig, I sent you guys some videos. Jack, I didn't send them to you. I'm sorry, because you're on a different provider. But anyway, I sent them to you. Of the Green Berets training at the farm. Mm-hmm. Did you see those guys?
Pretty neat.
These are manly men.
Oh, absolutely. And,
what they did.
Best of the best.
We have a world-class trainer across the street. She says, can we use your farm? And I said, for what? And she goes, well, we're going to set up an obstacle course. So in the barn, we set up a rope, and we set up trapeze, and we set up planks and everything, and out and on
do
the
you
pond.
Do you set it up?
Uh-huh.
You said you do whatever you want to do to set it up, or she
came in and said,
"This
is what I need,"
and so you do it.
I did it, yeah. And except for that tire, they have that big tire that the guys come in. If you imagine a huge tractor tire, they run these poor guys to death. They run them about a mile and a half to our farm, and then they get them in situations where they have to fire a pistol at three targets. They have to put their dog in a downstay, and the dog has to stay, or they lose points. So they're running like the Dickens. Then all of a sudden, they're stopped. Dog's panting, the guys, and they make him do things just like the Olympics. You know, you got to shoot targets and make them hit. And then the tractor tire was the one. This tractor tire, Terry, was so big, I could not even lift it.
I bet. I mean, they're so heavy.
These special forces guys come in. There's something about them. They're just really, they're short, squatty ones. There's one that's as tall as Abraham Lincoln. He's a Hawaiian. Unbelievable guy. But they just pick up these tires and throw them around. And I said, that's how I did it when I put them there, guys. You know, they did.
That's how they got there. Yeah.
That's how they got there. And then we take them out to the pond, and I laid out a 300-foot rope across it from tree to tree. And with their dog, they have to get on this raft and control their dog and pull themselves across the water. Two of them went in the drink. So then one of them, somebody has to get back on the raft, and it's a big raft, like you'd pull five or six teenagers behind a boat, one of those type of rafts, kind of canvassy. Uh-huh. So when the white guy went in the drink, first of all, I learned a whole bunch of new cuss words. Yeah. You know, special forces have cuss words that I have never heard.
What are the words, Denny? Go ahead and say
No. Yeah.
We also have a break.
That's all right. There were a couple police forces there. We had Whitestown there, and we had Rushville there, and both of those guys did really, really well. I mean, this is stiff comp. Anyway, they fall off the raft. They have to decide whether they're going to get themselves back on the raft first or the dogs back on the raft.
Boy, they better choose dog.
Well, two of them didn't, okay? But one of them did, and he got the dog up there. Well, then the dog wanted to play. And you could see the dog was already, all right, Dad, I'm ready to go. So, but then they pull themselves all the way across with the rope. Then they have to pull themselves back. And I left a little
pretty
bit of
amazing.
Out. It really is. Yep. But God bless them. I mean, one of the things that they had to do is they had to climb a 12-foot step ladder with a dog on their shoulder.
Oh. Yeah.
Now, we belayed off the dog because the last thing I wanted was somebody to fall. So we had one guy on belay. They'd hook it up to the harness of the dog. And as the guy was climbing, they would pull it up. And we had one guy, the dog fidgeted. And off went the dog. We saved the dog, and he grabbed himself on the ladder and saved himself. But
oh, my gosh.
It just is really thrilling to watch how these guys train. Now, here's what it was. We're just a training ground. The Canine Olympics are this week up at Von Licht Kennels, which is up by Grissom Air Force Base. So if you want to see that, I think that is open. You might be able to do that. But go to Von Licht Kennels. And it's the World Championship Olympics for canine handlers.
Pretty cool.
It was really cool. All right. Well, we're going to be taking your phone calls. 317-239.
Good story, Denny.
Thank you, Terry.
Allison liked it too. Jack liked it.
I think she was feeling bad because she was beeping and backing up a little earlier. But all right. 239-9393. When we come back, we'll take Margaret's call. Take your call too, right here on 93 WIBC.
I will write her an email. 93
WIBC here on a beautiful Saturday morning in central Indiana. You got to get out. I'll just say that. Mackie and I took a walk this morning. It was 60 degrees. Had to go back in and put on a sweatshirt because I got cold. I was in short sleeves. I wasn't expecting it. Enjoy every bit of that. Today, and tomorrow. It's going to be beautiful weather. I hope you get out to the state fair or at least get outside so you can enjoy it. In just a minute, we're going to have Michael Hawkins giving us a call here from the Michaelis Corporation. But right now, we've got a young lady here. Let me see if I can find my mouse. Here we go. Now I know why Pat complains over here. Hey, Margaret, good morning.
Hi, good morning.
What's up?
I had a follow-up question to the ivy and violet dilemma. I have a tremendous amount of it in my yard, and some of my concern with treating it is that it is, you know, under a bunch of bushes and under the arborvitas and things like that. So the suggestion for the weed killer that's safe for grass, is that still okay for that kind of an area?
Here's the thing. In the state of Indiana, the label is the law. So you have to look at whatever product you pull, however it needs to be applied, it has to be applied that way, or you're in violation of the laws for that type of thing. Now, the neat thing about Purdue is that they have a chemist there, and the state chemist, who can refer you to people. But more than that, Jack, on every label of every pesticide or herbicide, there's an 800 number, and those people are religious about manning that line.
They man it all day, every day.
But, Jack, what can you tell her about her ivy? Is it going to threaten the bushes and threaten the trees if we treat it?
Not necessarily, especially if you're using something that, you know, isn't wide broadcast spray, but maybe a more specific little stream application that you can kind of get right on that plant, not doing it during a windy day. But even a lawn-safe weed killer, I would be, you know, careful spraying around something like arborvitae.
Yeah, the bushes and the tree roots are really pretty deep, Margaret. So unless you get it on the foliage, I would think you'd be safe. But I absolutely read it. Jack, that triclopyr, do you know what product that comes in? Is it triclopyr is the chemical, but is there a specific product that you guys use for ground ivy?
Not that I can. I know Ortho has a few. I guess specific yard weed products. I'd have to check which one would be best for the ground ivy. But
yeah, Margaret, do you have somebody that treats your yard, the grass? Do you do it?
We do. No, we do have someone who just comes and kills weeds. Yes.
All right, I would talk to them and tell them specifically. You can send them a picture of it, or you can tell them that you think it's ground ivy or wild violets or some of the stinkers that are hard to kill.
Right.
But just say, hey, I need some help. You're my lawn guy.
Pat likes Ortho's Ground Clear.
That's it.
Okay.
You can find that at any hardware garden store. I don't know much other than that, but I do.
Yeah, well, these are all great suggestions, so it's really helpful.
Yeah. You don't want to kill anything except the bad guys. And so take the time to read it very, very carefully and just sit there in the store. Every time I go by, I think it's aisle 4 or aisle 6. I can't remember what aisle it is. Somebody's always in there reading the back of the label, which is exactly what you should do, Margaret. So, you know, don't worry about being a pest.
And I know you have to keep after it, too. It's not just once, one and done, right, Jack?
Yeah, it's a couple applications.
Ugh, that's annoying.
For sure.
It is, but the chemicals do work well. You know, as long as you follow the instructions, typically does.
Yeah, and don't overtreat. If you think a little is good, a lot is not. You really do have to fight. When they say it's 1 ounce per gallon, that's exactly what they mean. And if you overdose it, then I think you can get it into other trouble. But, Margaret, good luck to you, okay?
Oh, thank you so much.
You betcha. Doggone it. I hate ground ivy. You know, so does my septic tank. 239-9393, 239-9393. Next up, we've got Jeff with a squirrel problem. Hey, Jeff, how are you?
I got a question. So the wife is like on her third or fourth generation for sunflowers. So they grow 10 foot. Some of them are crossbreeds now. And we like the finches, the yellow finches maybe or whatever they are. There'll be a dozen of them eating them, but she'll take some of them off when they're ready and put them on the picnic table to dry them out. So we've got a fox squirrel, okay, a couple of them actually, and they're real keen to using everything they can in our yard. So he'll actually come up. We got pictures, and they'll just sit on the picnic table right while we're watching him. I've almost hand fed it before, and be eating it. You know, he picks the seeds out and eats all the seeds. So my wife's got a name for him. I can't say on air. It's called Little Bath, and you can finish it.
Yeah.
So thank you for censoring.
Our fingers were on the dump button, brother. Okay.
No, I don't. We don't need to use that. So here's my problem. We got corn growing out there. So now the little bass has come out there. He hops over the fence. We've got to keep the rabbits and other critters out, and actually takes the corn off and chews the whole thing and leaves the husk and the, you know, whatever. And he's eating the corn. He goes from the sunflowers to the corn. So what will work on that? Well, I mean, will a scarecrow work, or they're just too domesticated?
Probably not. I had a farmer that was a commercial feed farmer. In other words, he was trying to feed the people, and he would do sweet corn. And I said, well, how do you keep the raccoons and the squirrels off it? He says, you have a sacrificial row, and he says, you put it on the outside. You put two rows on the outside for the critters, and on the inside, he says, I just ride off the outside, and he says, then I harvest the inside. But he says, I have to give them something because they're going to do it one way or the other. As far as your little buddy, and does your wife want to save the sunflower seeds for something else? Is she wanting to eat them too?
No. See, she replants them. She calls it a generation. Oh, you know, so she and it's okay. You know, and that's a genius idea, Denny, because, yeah, we are going to, we'll just do a sacrificial row or two, like you said, on the outside and keep them out of the garden for us and our corn.
Yeah, and
so
she
thought about that. That's why you're the man.
Take a bit. No, wait a minute. And I would just, Jack, is there anything wrong with taking a big machete, cutting it right in half, give the squirrel half or a quarter, and then you take the rest of it inside?
Absolutely
or
not.
Put it on the front porch?
So they did the first Thanksgiving.
Pick some of the worst seed heads, give those to the squirrels.
Yeah, there
keep
you go.
The best for yourself.
You all right, Jeff, you're a plumber. You're a heavy equipment operator. You can figure this one out, okay?
Thank you.
I love you, brother. Take care of yourself. 239-9393. You know, somebody who really and truly knows an awful lot about sunflowers and squirrels and everything is Michael Hawkins from Michalis.
Oh, wow.
Michael, how are you this morning?
Good. How are you guys doing?
Doing good. Hey, I got an email from the program director this week about a roof that had failed 2 years after it was put on. And it caused interior ceiling damage and everything. And I'm going to be trying to hook them up with some experts. Of course, you're going to be one of them. But the poor people, they came out and had a multi-year warranty. And the contractor came out and said, well, yeah, but the flashing, it looks like it's a flashing problem. So we'll do this for free, but we're not responsible for anything on the inside. Mike, I got to believe that a roofing contractor that's worth his salt is going to take care of everything, flashing, siding, roofing. Michalis is not like that, are they?
Absolutely not. If we are going to take the time to install a roof for a customer that was referred to us, and then 2 years later, 3 years later down the road, they have an issue due to improper install or flashing not being sealed correctly, you are 100% correct. We will take care of that problem for the customer.
Yeah.
That's just the right thing to do.
So you're doing gutters, siding, roofing. You're the outside guy. You don't get to get inside the house at all, do you, buddy?
I don't get to get inside the house, but we can take care of inside damage caused by a leaky roof or improper install where water gets through and causes mold issues or, you know, whatever the case may be.
The roofing that you guys use, do you go full dimensional? Do you have the showroom where people can look at the different sizes, the 10-year, 20-year, 30-year? How long do roofing guarantees go out now?
Roofing guarantees as far as, like, warranties for the manufacturer?
Yeah.
Yeah, most of them are 5 years.
5 years. Golly.
Yes, sir. 5 years. But yeah, we use the architectural shingle or the 3D shingle, as some people call it. The way that they're rated nowadays, they're a lot more secure when storms come, that they could take a lot more damage before anything would happen to them.
The same old number that we use when we call into Michalis, 844-FIX-INDY, whether it's the roof, the siding, the gutters, y'all do it, they call on the same number?
Yes, you can call on the same number. Tell us what the problem is or what you're kind of experiencing, and we have a whole team that is ready to go as soon as you call.
That sounds great. Michael, thank you. Anything else you want us to know?
No, sir. Michalis is the name to know. We can take care of the entire house for you guys. Free inspections and estimates.
Sounds good. All right. Now, what about this squirrel problem, eating the sunflower seeds? You got anything on that, buddy?
Well, I grew up on a farm as a kid, and whoever the gentleman was before that is exactly correct. We would plant rows of waste to kind of deter the rodents away from the house, the barns, the animal. I grew up with cows and pigs, and so we always had grain and seed. So we had to plant decoy rows of corn to
decoy rows. There you go. Yep. I knew. I remember what he was telling me. I didn't know what you called them. Decoy rows. That works.
Decoy rose is what we call them. That's what we call them growing up, and that is the best idea to do.
There you go. Michael Hawkins from the Michaelis Corporation. Thanks for joining us today, brother.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys. I appreciate y'all.
Thank you.
Water, storms, fire, and wet basements. Life happens. Michaelis happens to help you through it. 844-FIX-INDY. All right, the studio is abuzz because this is going to be a group activity today for In the Weeds. We have 60 interesting facts that I have found over the week, and I've given each one of the participants, Landon Coons at the board, the lovely Allison Lemons, Terry Lynn Stacy, and Jack Phipps, all in here, and we're all going to test each other with some fun facts. So I'm going to start off. There are only 5 countries in the world that don't have an airport. Can you name one?
Ethiopia.
No, Ethiopia's got one.
Well, I didn't know. I've never been out of the country. That was my first guess.
You have never been out of the country?
Nope.
Have you been to Terre Haute?
Sure.
Well, that's close.
Okay. That's fair.
All right. 5 countries that don't have an airport.
The Bermuda Triangle.
I'll give you one. San Marino. I'll give you another one. Monaco, which is, you know, south of France there.
Okay. Luxembourg.
Close. Jack's so close. Anybody want to give me one more?
What's it start with? The letter.
How about someplace?
Oh, like Vatican. Someplace holy?
The Vatican City. Yeah, Jack got that. So here are the 5. Vatican City, San Marino, Jack. Monaco, Liechtenstein.
Vatican City is a country?
Vatican City. Oh, yeah.
Like an independent state.
They're an independent state.
Oh, I guess in my mind I didn't consider it a country.
I didn't think it was a country either.
All right. Who wants to go next with a question?
Go ahead, Allison.
Oh, okay. This one's a little bit disturbing.
Cool.
This kind of fruit can be a year old at the supermarket when you buy it.
Banana.
Ooh. Banana? Green banana? What is the matter with you, Jack?
Some of those big plantains.
That might be. Pumpkins. All right. So fruit is a whole year old?
A fruit, yes, could be a whole year old at the supermarket.
Pineapple?
It's a good one.
I don't know.
Squash.
Would it be?
Is this going to scare us?
I think it's probably something we don't know that is a fruit, like coffee or something.
Like close.
Vegetable.
I mean, I think coffee is a bean, right. So it's a.
Ding, ding, ding. I give up. What we got?
Apples.
Oh.
What?
No way.
Is that real?
Apples, you guys are thinking way too hard. Those fresh apples aren't always that fresh. They're usually picked between August and November, covered in a wax, hot air dried, and then sent into cold storage.
Get
out of
here.
After 6 to 12 months, they finally land on your grocery store shelves.
That was a good one, Allison.
Wow.
So definitely wash those apples.
One.
All right, Jack.
Okay.
You got a question for us?
Yeah, mine's amusement park themed.
Amusement parks, okay.
Okay, so roller coasters, one of America's favorite pastimes, wasn't invented just for fun, but instead was invented for a certain purpose. In the 1880s, can anybody guess what that purpose was?
Nausea control.
Adrenaline rusher.
Ooh.
1880s.
1880s.
1880s. NASA.
Any guesses? NASA.
I think NASA is a good guess.
G-force training.
Yeah.
No. In the 1880s, Hoosiery businessman LaMarcus Thompson said people were tempted by hedonistic places like saloons and brothels and wanted some old, good, clean fun.
He invented a roller coaster to keep people out of bars?
And one of the most immoral places he could think of, Coney Island.
Is that great?
Coney Island.
No. All right. No way.
No way. All
it's
right.
So fun.
Terry, do you want to go next? Or do you want to pass to Landon?
Landon, you go. You do yours.
Okay. All right. So an Asian elephant weighs up to nearly 8,000 pounds.
Okay.
What ocean animal body part can weigh as much as that?
Oh, a
whale's
whale.
Brain.
You got the animal right.
We got the animal right.
Whale's
but
tail.
Not his brain.
Mm-mm.
Not his brain, something else.
His fin.
And
body
not his
part?
Tail.
Yeah, what body part?
Tail.
Outside outside part inside. Or inside? Inside
stomach.
Part.
His stomach.
No, huh?
Liver? Lungs?
Kidneys.
Tongue.
tongue.
Oh. That yeah. makes sense.
Oh, that's yeah. a good
I,
one.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Can you imagine putting that on your resume? Yeah, I weigh whale's tongues.
Yeah.
Okay, Terry Lynn, what's your question?
I have our only really hard ones, but this kind of goes along with Landon's being that this is an ocean creature. What ocean creature, when threatened, they will shoot out their internal organs, which are poisonous
Jellyfish.
To the predators? No, but that's good. Sometimes they get rid of their entire digestive system.
Sea cucumber.
It. Yes! Yeah. Oh. Jack, you... I can't even believe you got that.
Are you a marine biologist?
No, I've seen a few BBC, Planet Earth,
those are good.
Blue Planet.
Sea cucumbers.
Yeah. They do that?
All right, so I have a home care question, all right?
Okay.
Does bleach expire?
That's so good.
Does
I'm so
bleach
proud of you.
Ever expire, yes or no?
Does bleach?
No. Bleach.
Ever expire?
Yeah, do you ever see an expiration date on bleach?
No.
Mm-mm. I'm going to say yes.
Jack, that was a good guess. This home cleaning product lasts 6 months, but not any longer. So all these people that have always stored bleach, you know, for purifying water and everything.
Oh, I know so many people.
I know. My grandma and grandpa did it. They
I
stored
bet it
bleach.
Still really works. It probably smells a little bad, but I bet it still really will work. A little
but you're
bit.
Saying after
I think
6 months.
That about,
after
I,
6 months.
I do think that about
it.
Everything.
Does the chemical makeup change?
I must. Deary, I don't know. Goes back to water.
That's two in the weeds.
All right, Allison, you got one more here. What you got?
Oh, only one more? Well, okay. People used to say this word instead of cheese when having their picture taken. And I will give you a hint. The word is also, I think, a fruit.
A fruit? Not banana, not orange.
Tomato. Tomatoes.
Fruit.
Strawberries.
Apple. I'm going to go with apple every time now.
They didn't always say cheese?
It didn't always say cheese. Landon, do you have a guess?
I was jokingly, I was just like, rutabaga.
Kiwi.
Rutabaga.
Prunes.
Prunes.
Your
so
lips.
You
got the kissy
like
face.
Prune.
In the 1840s, saying cheesy was seen as childish. So one London photographer told people to say prunes to keep their mouth taut. And by the way, I have heard this before. Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen, the famous 90s twins.
Yeah.
They have that's their red carpet trick. They say prunes because when you're saying prunes on the red carpet, you have like a little pout to your lip. So I have heard this before. So saying prunes instead of cheese is more mature. Prune.
All right, Jack, cheese. Can you top prune. That?
Cheese also, makes you actually like almost like cheese. You're kind of a, at least
you're
a
showing,
grin.
It makes you smile.
Yeah, cheese, prunes. Here,
this last one will make
the
you smile,
is
too.
Making you
all right, what do you got, Jack
serious.
Phipps?
Okay, so what was invented by an 11-year-old boy on accident when he left his soda powder and water outside overnight?
Soda powder and water has to be like a Kool-Aid
with
or
with his wooden stirrer still in the cup.
With his wooden stirrer still in the cup, like a frozen malted thing.
Mm, but I do love but a malt, but
I
no.
Do. I hate that wooden spoon. I don't. Hate it.
Okay, it's got to be some frozen treat, but if he left it outside.
Popsicle.
Water, powder,
it is a popsicle, originally called an Epsicle.
Epsicle.
Why'd they call it an Epsicle?
Because his name was Frank Epperson.
Wait, so they call it a popsicle because it's made from pop?
Well, no. Would have been another good question. But he sold it around his neighborhood and amusement parks to the point where his kids called it popsicle because it was his pops's concoction.
Oh.
That's good.
Wow, popsicle. That's a good one.
All right, Landon, one more.
Good. One.
All right, I'm going to do this one Jeopardy style here. This famous artist wrote a poem about how much he hated painting a certain chapel.
What is Michelangelo?
That is correct. 500 for you.
Yes.
Wow. Daily double.
Why did he write a poem?
I don't know. It said, one translation of the poem he sent from his friends begins with, I've already grown a... I'm not even going to attempt this word. Goiter? G-O-I-T-E-R.
Oh, goiter. That's
goiter.
In the
goiter. Yeah. I've already grown a goiter from this torture, hunched up here like a cat in Lombardy, or anywhere else where the stagnant water's poison. Doesn't sound like he was too thrilled with his last guess.
Have you guys been to Sistine Chapel?
No, I've just seen the
It's
picture.
Amazing. And I, when they were talking about it, they said his neck was so cranked all the time. So it's, I mean, you have to literally, you're looking up at ceiling. It has to be so uncomfortable. And that ceiling's rather large.
Imagine
so.
The ladder you had to use to get up on that.
Yeah.
Thing.
Yeah.
I don't blame them.
I'll tell you a trick.
Advil wasn't a thing back then.
Plumbers have to work underneath the sinks, and we can either work on our back or we can
front,
but we're always looking
poor
up.
Poor mechanics, same way.
As you get older, you have bifocals, and you can't get back. So you know what the trick is?
No.
You turn your glasses upside down so the bifocals are on the top. And you know where the plumbers learned that?
No.
They learned that from the piano players, because the piano players, they were cranking their neck back to see it, and so they had turned theirs upside down, so the piano players taught the plumbers.
Well, somebody should invent a glasses for those
exactly.
industries. Like there's a market for that.
Exactly. All right, Terry Lynn, you're the last one.
Oh, is there another one? Okay.
Got one more.
This particular berry is really not a berry.
Dinkle.
A dinkleberry?
Goji.
I think a dinkleberry is really a dinkleberry.
A
goji is really a berry. This word rhymes with pawberries.
Strawberries. That was real subtle. Okay. Well,
and
there
why,
we...
Wait. Why is it not a strawberry? Why is it not a real berry?
Neither are raspberries and blackberries, according to botanists, because true berries stem from one single ovary flower and have two or more seeds. Strawberries don't fit that bill, but bananas, kiwis, and watermelons do.
I don't like that at all.
Now, wasn't that a fun in the weeds? Everybody
gosh,
was
yes.
participating, was have fun. All right, turn your papers in. I'll make some new ones for next week.
Okay.
And when we come back, we've got Mary, who's got a plant question. So Jack's here from Allisonville Home and Garden by Sullivan. And we'll take more of your calls, too, right here on 93 WIBC. What a great Saturday morning. 239-9393. We're taking your calls. Home and Garden. Got Allison in here, so matters of the heart. Terry's here. She can talk about anything. Landon's here if you want to talk about sports, but we're going to save that for another day. Right now, we're going to talk to Mary, though. Mary, thanks for taking time to call us. How are you?
I'm good. I'm a first-time caller, so you know.
Oh, we're harmless. Just have fun, okay?
Ding, 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 ding.
All right, Mary, what do you got?
So we just moved into a new house in October, and of course spring and summer came, and we have, and I can't remember the name of the tree, but it like spreads everywhere, like the thorns.
A locust tree,
it, like,
I would guess.
That's what it is.
Okay.
When the heck do I get rid of it?
Napalm. I don't know. Nuclear waste. All right, Jack. This is such an easy question. How do you get rid of a locust tree?
Well, you could easily call a tree company. Quite a few places around the area. If you're able to cut it back, I would cut it back. How big is the tree itself? Is it small?
Well, so that's the thing, is people who had the house before us didn't really upkeep it. So, like, there was a tree that was probably about... I mean, it was a humongous tree that fell over, and I just cut off the end of it. Well, the whole entire tree is wrapped in it. So I don't know where the original tree is at, but it's spreading like everywhere, like freaking wildfire. It's insane.
Yeah, they're pretty prolific. Have you enjoyed the crop of the locust seed pods yet? They look biblical, is what they look like. They can be as long as your forearm. And they're real crinkly and curly. If you haven't seen those yet, you're in for a real treat. But you can catch them.
No.
Jack's right. If you don't want the tree, cut it down.
Yeah.
There's too many other good substitutes for it.
But then I would use like a stump vine killer just to kill back that trunk, because they are pretty vigorous trees.
Well, but the thing is, I don't know where the original tree is.
They'll find it. Yeah. This is a sort of a quiet time. We haven't had any storms, knock on wood. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But you call a tree company to come out. There's Davy Tree Service. If you want an arborist to come out and sort of bird dog it, you can do that. Send me an email to denny@wibc.com. I'll give you a couple companies you can get. But I would not tackle a locust tree by myself. Jack,
no.
Those things could
especially
kill you.
Especially if it's more than 10 feet
yeah.
mixed in up there.
The thorns are humongous. The thorns are like the length of my finger.
Oh, yeah, they're dangerous.
You've got some drama to you, Mary. I like you.
Yeah. This sounds pretty scary. I don't like it.
Well, the funny thing is when my old house, my father-in-law came over, and first time I'd met him at the time, and he's like, that tree right there that you planted a couple years ago. And I was like, yeah. He goes, it's a locust tree, right? And I said, yeah. He goes, you're going to hate that. It's going to pop up everywhere. And I'm like, I've had it for 5 years. No problem. The next year, they were everywhere.
Oh, Mary, get yourself an arborist or a tree service, because I think that's going to be the safest thing for you. Thanks for calling, Mary. You can give us a call, too, 317-239-9393. We'll help you as best we can. But I need to talk to some people about what's going on at the Olympics. Did anybody see the breakdancing?
Oh, did we ever?
Did we ever? The world is obsessed with what
they really are. Dancing.
Are Australians?
Look, what's happening? Wiggling on the ground like a worm. And then flipping upside down. I mean, it really is incredible.
Do we know who came in first for the first ever break competition?
Well, I mean, you're not going to get first place for doing the can opener.
No.
Is that the can opener?
I don't know, or like the wiggly worm or whatever.
I don't know what it is.
She truly just laid on the ground and just touched her
toes.
She's
doing the
multiple
floppy
times.
She's flopping.
And you know what?
Or he's flopping. I don't know.
She did the best she could, and I think she won the hearts of the world.
Do you?
But how many people wanted to go do that?
But at what risk? I don't know.
Yeah, now that was from she was from Australia, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh man. I'm sorry.
Because like,
I mean, there's a place for it. I just don't know if it's Olympics. Yeah. You know.
I will say it felt very out of place, and I'm interested how they judge that. But Japan was
difficulty.
The one who.
The other comment I have on the breaking: why are they the only athletes that don't use their real name? It's like you'll see Twisted Logic dancing.
Japanese B girl was the one who was the first champion of the Olympics.
That's kind of funny. They didn't use their real names.
It's the only sport that I've seen in the Olympics that they don't use their real name.
All right. Yeah. So, personal question to all of you. Did you ever put down the cardboard in the front yard or in the garage? You ever try to break dance?
I tried when I was little, but wasn't successful at it.
We had wood floors and socks, and that seemed to do the trick.
That seemed to do the trick. Can you do the splits? Oh, my goodness. I did it one time, and I tried to get a spin, fell right on my keister, and I thought, this is dumb. And then from that point on, I just became a spectator.
So here's the next question. What is everyone's break dancer name?
Oh,
I have no idea. That's actually my name. I have no idea.
Breakdancer
name?
That's
my name. I have no idea.
Did you guys see I Have No Idea last night?
Mine is It Is What It Is. Yeah. It is what it is.
You didn't answer. Have you ever done any breakdancing?
I don't think so. I don't think I would be able to get up off the ground after.
Well, that's
I'm always impressed.
That's me all the time.
Mine would be Take It or Leave It.
Take It or Leave It.
All right, when we come back, we're talking about floors. When we come back, we're going to have some flooring experts. I have had question after question about floors, and I finally thought, I got to find a good flooring expert. If you've ever been up Allisonville Road and you saw the great big stallion, I reached out to the ladies at E.F. Marburger, who are fourth, fifth, sixth, I don't know how many generations they've been there. We're going to learn about some flooring when we come back. And, of course, we're going to be taking your phone calls, too. It's 317-239-9393. Just got a text message. Where's Pat? I know you miss him. Allison, you probably are as close to his den mother as any of us. Do you know what country he's in right now?
I do not, but I do know he and his wife are on a cruise right now. So they started in Italy, and they're making their way
across the world.
Across the world. I thought anyone else.
They're making their way one direction over.
Yeah. The ocean
blue. Was supposed to be just a 3-hour tour.
Yeah.
But
boy, Gilligan's Island. I saw where you're going there. Before. Yeah. Who would he be on Gilligan's Island? Who would Pat Sullivan be? He'd probably be the captain. You know.
I don't know.
I think I would be Gilligan if he's going to be the captain. 239-9393.
Where does Denny's brain go?
I don't know.
Isn't it something?
Well, she said it'd be a 3-hour tour. Haven't you ever heard the song of Gilligan's Island?
That would be the movie star.
A 3-hour tour. The weather started getting rough. The tiny chip. Don't you know Gilligan's?
Yeah.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
It is the Home and Garden Show. We're brought to you by the Michaelis Corporation. Water storm, fires, wet basements, life happens. Michaelis happens to help you through it. We're grateful for the sponsorship. If you need them, and you might, whether it's the roof, all the way down to the crawl space, they can give you a hand. It's 844-FIX-INDY. My name's Denny Smith. Pat Sullivan's on vacation. Allison Lemons, Terry Stacy, Jack Phipps, and, of course, the famous Landon Coons on the board right here on 93 WIBC.
Oh,
Some folks say that grown-up men are still just little boys. That really the only difference is the price of our toys. We go for macho symbols like guns and running shoes, pickup trucks, hunting ducks, and power tools, power tools.
93 WIBC, the home of Pat Sullivan, of course, who's on vacation. My name's Denny Smith. In the studio with me, I've got Allison Lemons, Jack Phipps, Terry Stacy. Landon's on the board. And I also have two lovely ladies who are experts in flooring.
You're getting a little blushed, Denny.
You know.
You're just so excited about this flooring.
You know what? I have never been able to really decide on flooring. When we were growing up, we either had carpet. We might have linoleum if we were really cool, and that was in the kitchen. But I don't even remember hardwoods except Grandma and Grandpa's cabin down in Brown County. But the world has changed, and joining me right now is Kim Marburger and Kelly Marburger. They are with E.F. Marburger. If you have driven up Allisonville Road and you saw the big stallion, these ladies, whose horse was it? Kim, was that your horse?
No, my stepmom bought it. My stepmom bought it for my dad.
Oh, that is really cool. Did the horse have a name?
No, not really. He bought it for his house that he was building, and then the house wasn't ready yet, so he's like, I'm just going to stick it at the office for now. And it's a huge bronze stallion, so they had to bring in a crane and everything and drop it. And then by the time his house was done, he was like, I don't really want to mess with it. I'm just going to leave it there.
It's a landmark. Yeah. How tall is it? I mean, it must be 8-9 feet
it's
tall.
It's probably 8 or 9 feet, and if any of your kids or grandkids or anything did Pokemon, it's a Pokestop. So if you did that game, you could.
Of course
yeah.
it is.
Nice.
My kids were young at the time, so I'd have to bring their devices in and get Pokeballs.
Oh,
whatever.
Wow.
So it's kind of fun.
This is Kim. Oh,
that's hilarious.
That was Kelly Marburger Novak. Kim, if I understand it right, you're the one that does all the commercial flooring for, well, you're the commercial side.
Yes.
And Kelly, you are the residential side.
Correct.
Yeah. So I'll tell you right up front, Kel, I'm a big fan of staying away from the box doors for this type of flooring. Everybody thinks that Marburger is all commercial, which it is commercial. Gosh, didn't you do some hotels down at Atlanta? I'm trying to remember that story.
Savannah, Georgia.
Savannah, Georgia. Yeah. Those are big hotels.
There were
three of them, if I remember
right.
Yeah,
right on the river, Plant Riverside, JW Marriott.
Wow. Unbelievable. But yet, you also can do my kitchen if I'm ready for my kitchen flooring.
Absolutely.
That's right.
Any project is large enough, small enough, we'll do it all.
All right. So let's start with waterproofing, okay? It used to be said that we would never put hardwood in a kitchen. Now I'm starting to see hardwood in the kitchen. But then because of disasters, because it's a kitchen, we're coming up with waterproofing stuff. Tell me about the markets for waterproof products in the kitchen that don't look like tile.
Yeah, they've come out with so many now. The vinyl waterproof is still probably the most popular. It looks like wood. They also have a tile look. And then now laminate's coming back where they have a waterproof laminate product. It's great because they don't scratch or dent, you know.
No dog marks at all?
Dog-proof practically. I have it in my house because I have two huge dogs. So it works great. You can't beat the look of a hardwood floor. I still love that. But for practicality with kids, dogs, the vinyl is really nice.
So what's going on in the homes right now? Are we still seeing a lot of hardwood? Do you guys do hardwoods,
by
the way?
Yeah, we do. Yeah, we do it all. And I would say it's probably 50-50. Half the people go with the hardwood and then the other half. And it just kind of depends on where you are in your life, what stage, if you've got, like I said, kids and dogs and all that. Because the looks of the vinyl now really are, they're gorgeous compared to kind of 20, 30 years ago.
Yeah. Kelly and Kim Marburger, if you've got a question about flooring, this is your chance to give us a call, 317-239-9393. One of the questions that I have, and I'm going to go to Kim on this one. When I go into a hotel, I notice that there is no long nap of the carpet. It's always a rather short nap, and they are these huge patterns. But yet you go into anybody's home, it's always a thicker plush, and there's really no patterns that you can really see. How do they make those big-ass patterns on that carpet? How do they do that?
It's a lot of it's woven.
Okay.
Woven, and it's wool carpet also.
It's wool?
Just, yeah, a lot of it is, yeah. And it's...
Is it wool because it lasts longer, Kim?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they have some wool blends and... A lot of them anymore now are even going to carpet tile patterns.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. You also do, besides the flooring, you'll also do wall coverings. Do you do the walls too?
It just depends. I mean, we do a lot of tile on walls, you know, backsplashes, accent walls in hotels, glass. And then we do cabinets and countertops as well.
Countertops.
Yeah.
You know, we've gone through this. Everybody wants granite. I've got granite at home, and I'm not really crazy about granite. I think it's a pain in the butt. But you give me some decent quartz, or you give me some decent, you know, there are so many other products. Yeah. Any thoughts about countertops and what's where that's going?
Quartz definitely has kind of taken over. There's so many different varieties, and it looks, you can get it to look like granite or marble or, you know, soapstone or anything. So it's, and it's a lot of ease. You don't have to seal it. It's just, it's gorgeous. You know, you can do so many different thicknesses and patterns and everything.
Landon, tell me.
Oh, no, I was going to say, we have a call. Someone's wanting to know about some waterproofing.
Well, there we go. Let's give it a shot. You ready, ladies?
Yep.
All right, here we go.
Don't scare him.
Yeah. No, I didn't scare him. You know.
Best of luck.
Hey, Ken, thanks for joining us here on the Home and Garden Show. You got a question for us?
Yes, sir. I'm living right now an old pole barn from the 1960s. It's being converted into a barndominium, as they call them nowadays. It was a barndominium before barndominiums were cool. But anyway, I'm getting ready to transfer, remodel, and I'm on a concrete slab. And I want to know what I should put down underneath there to kind of keep any moisture from coming through to hit the laminate floor.
What a great question. Okay, either one of you want to take a swing at that? Concrete floor, it's a remodel of a barn dominium, which means that's where he spent most of his time in his marriage, and so he's going to go ahead and make a house out of it. Is that right, Ken?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
That is correct. All right, so what are we going to do with the floor?
So I would always, you know, first you want to look to the manufacturer recommendation, see what they say. But typically with that, you would use a thin, it's that you could call it a pad, but it's almost like a moisture barrier. You can, you know, we sell it. You can get it a lot of different places. But it's basically like a thin moisture barrier. It comes in rolls.
You roll that right down on the concrete itself?
Mm-hmm.
All right, and then you're putting mastic on top of that?
No, it's probably just a floating floor, I'm guessing. You just click it together.
Yeah. It's a laminate, one of the new waterproof laminates like you were just talking about. It's absolutely beautiful.
Yep.
It's in my daughter's room now, and I did put down the padding, but I was afraid that even though I taped the seams, that moisture would still come up through those seams. I was even thinking about Tyvek laying it down as a moisture barrier first and then putting the padding down, but I'm afraid the concrete, that might make the concrete sweat, and then I have a moisture issue there again.
Yeah, as long as you don't have any cracks in your concrete.
It's been there since 1960, so I'm sure there's some small, you know, cracks in the concrete. Yeah, I'm not going to say it's a perfect concrete, no.
I mean, sometimes they'll recommend doing a crack suppressor. It's just like a roll-on, isn't that right? Roll-on.
Yeah, and you can even, there's primers that you can roll on. And feel free to call us on Monday, and we can help you out.
Yeah, I would first.
I mean, you can do some moisture tests to figure out what your moisture levels are, and then that might
better.
Yeah,
that's a little bit out of my realm.
Yeah.
How big? Okay, are they expansion cracks or are they compression cracks where something has fallen on it? Do you know, Ken?
Yeah, some of them's compression fractures, and some of them are, you know, the cut lines or the, you know, the crack line for the fracture joints. And those I've either sealed myself, you know, with a sealant or something like that, so nothing can come up through it. But I'm just talking for the actual concrete itself.
Kelly,
I mean,
sounds
even
like
it's in the 60s, it's still moisture.
Yeah, so Kelly, it sounds like he's got two issues. One is he might have to dress that concrete and get that squared away. But as far as the moisture, this felt or this layer you put down, that will stop the moisture from coming up?
Yeah, that shouldn't be all you need. Again, I would just double check with your manufacturer, but because they'll usually put a recommendation in, but that should be all. Anything else I think would be overkill.
All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate you. God bless you all, and I hope you have a wonderful day.
Thanks for calling, Kenny. Now, see, that's a typical question that we look at and we say, oh, my gosh, how am I going to handle that? And it's nice to know. Do you guys take phone calls like that all the time?
Yeah, definitely.
That's pretty much it.
Yep.
You might have a question too. 239-9393. Kim and Kelly Marburger. I'm going to call you both Marburger.
Yep.
Okay. Well, it's just the fourth generation.
Yep.
Fourth generation.
Yeah. Our great grandfather started it in 1913.
He's the EF.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it stood for what?
Eli Franklin.
Eli Franklin. And then his son was your grandfather.
Yep.
Yep.
And your father still involved?
He's retired.
He's retired.
Yeah. A few years ago.
It's because he wants to.
Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Here's for those of you who didn't grow up in a family business, the one thing about family business is there is no filters. It's worse than a radio station, Allison, you know, when people have been around for a while. They have no filters. They'll say whatever they want. Oh, you colored your hair that color. You know, so, and then it's a knockdown dragout from there. But fourth generation, is there a fifth generation?
Yes, my son is there, yeah? Full-time project manager.
Really? Yep. And, you know, there could be a lot of generations going on. Do you know what the chances of that is? Only, I think, 20% make it to the third generation. Less than 0.1% would make it to the fifth generation. So that's an incredible business.
I had heard that statistic when we took over, mm-hmm. and it was a little daunting. But I feel like over the years with, you know, my grandfather and our father and everything, each new generation has kind of brought new insight and
new,
you know, and thoughts. Not that necessarily they're going to do it better, but they're going to follow the original traditions and then bring up, you know, implement something new and exciting.
Hey, we've got a bunch of calls here. So we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back. We're going to learn about replacing tiles, underlayment, and carpet squares. And you heard it here first on the Home and Garden Show right here on 93 WIBC. 93 WIBC. We're going to have the Marburger ladies here for just a little bit longer. E.F. Marburger has been around Indiana for how long? When did you guys get started? 1913. That's the voice of Kelly Marburger. Kim is her sister. And do sisters fight?
Not too much.
The nice thing is if we do fight, it's 10 seconds later, well, let's go to lunch now. You know, like that's, we just get over it.
That's the way it is. Yep. That's the way it is. Well, anyway, they are the fourth generation of E.F. Marburger. We've had so many questions about floors and flooring, and not the least of which are people calling in right now. So I'm going to pull up Brad here. Brad, welcome to the Home and Garden Show. You got a question for Kim or Kelly?
Yes. We have a textured tile with light grout that goes from into our kitchen and great room, and it is a bear to keep clean. So the question is, I mean, I'm assuming we're going to have to move out if we're going to have this stuff replaced, but is there a industrial sealant that you guys would put on something like this to keep it from getting dirty?
That's a great question. Everybody's got dirty grout.
Yeah, definitely for the grout there is. You'll want to clean it really good with, you know, like a chemical that's recommended, and then seal it. Now for the tile itself, again, you'll want to clean it. And there's so many different applications now. Is there one for tile itself? I think there is.
Depends on the tile, really. Yeah.
Just getting it to stick to it and stay, and then our issues. But yeah, there's several different products that could, and there's us, for example, companies out there will come out and actually clean it for you as well. If you don't want to mess with it,
Kelly, can you get it back to the way it was?
Pretty close.
Can you really?
Yeah. Typically. Yeah. Sometimes if the grout's really badly stained, they'll have to cut out the grout, regrout it.
Hey, Brad, do you use your toothbrush? That's what I've been using. Yeah. Do you use your? I thought so. You know, use your toothbrush to clean it up. But then it still gets dirty. So what is the sealant? Is it a silicone? Is it a wax? What is it?
It's like a water based. Yeah. They have a couple different. There's some that you spray on, some you roll on, some you wipe on.
How long does it last? Because Brad doesn't want to do this again.
Yeah. It probably like a minimum 5 years to maybe 10. And it, again, it depends on traffic and everything.
Brad, you may not want to bust it all out of there and start over. They'd have big smiles if you would do that, but, you know, beats using your toothbrush.
Well, to your point...
I would want them to come out and do it for me. Right now, about once a year, we have Zero Res come out, and they do a great job on it.
Yeah.
But it gets dirty in between.
Allison?
I'll just say they're perfect for putting that sealant on so you don't have to clean it as much. But to your point, Denny, about using a toothbrush and getting on your hands and knees, sometimes that is a lot of hard work. That's a lot of physical work. So reaching out to companies like E.F. Marburger honestly is a great investment.
But I just wanted somebody who answered these type. Look at this. We got a full board here all lit up.
That's great.
Any truth to the matter that you can use Crest whitening toothpaste on your grout to clean it? I'm a sucker. I read Dr. Google now.
I don't know. I'm only, if there's bleach in it, then it will bleach out the grout, the color. So that would be my only concern.
So if you have a darker grout, like a cream colored or a brown type grout, can you still clean that?
Yeah.
She's very confident, Brad. I like this woman. All right. Let's go to Paul. Hey, Paul, how are you?
Very good. Thank you.
Good. I've got some pros in the studio, so if you've got underlayment questions, now's your shot, buddy.
Yeah, I have a project where I've removed all the carpet out of our house, and we're putting in underlayment and then looking at putting in vinyl plank. And the vinyl plank that we're looking at has a cork backing. And my first question is if it has the cork-type backing or some type of a pad on a vinyl plank, do I need to put that underlayment on top of the subfloor then as well? Or, you know, I read mixed things.
Great, yeah. Great question. All right. Underlayment, or does it need underlayment if you've got a cork back?
It shouldn't need underlayment with a cork back. But again, depending, there's so many different rules now and so many different manufacturers. I would just double check with the manufacturer recommendations. They'll tell you exactly. They'll say, you know, you need 3/4 inch subfloor and then 1/4 inch underlayment. You don't need a film. Or sometimes, you know, on concrete, like we talked about, you do need a pad or a film. But with a cork back, typically you don't need anything.
Oh, okay, great. My second question has to deal with the subfloor itself. The house that we have has a 1/2 inch plywood, and then it has a particle board, a 1/2 inch of particle board on top of it as well. And I've never dealt with a floor with that kind of a particle board, and I wondered do I need to put some type of other layer on top of that or something, or have you ran into that type of construction? This is the first place I've ever lived where I ran into that.
And is that where your LVT is going to go?
Hold on. That's where his LVT is going to go, right?
Yeah, you should be okay with you know, a pad between that and the LVT.
Okay, very good. And the last question is leveling. Leveling versus flatness, right? If on this house is an older house, and when they removed the wall in the main area, it has a slight rise in it, although it is kind of gradual. Do I need to still put some type of leveling compound or something like that on it, or will the LVP take the form pretty well of that type of a rise, I should say?
So there's two types of LVP, basically. There's a rigid core, which will not forgive anything. And then there's the other one, which is WPC, I think they call it. It's a little bit more forgiving. I think with a cork back, typically that is a little bit more forgiving. I mean, you're still going to want the floor to be relatively flat, but because then you're going to have problems. But you might check out the kind that you have and see what they recommend, but typically it's a little bit more forgiving.
Thanks for the phone call, Paul. So when you guys check level, do you check with a 2-foot level, a 4-foot level? Yes?
Yeah.
Kelly's shaking her head at me. I'll tell you the plumber's trick. When we set a stool, the first thing we do is we used to take a squirt gun and put it on the tile floor and see if it went one way or the other way. But it was usually linoleum when I was in the trade.
Right.
And that's how we'd know whether a floor was level or not. What do you guys use? Just a level?
Levels, typically.
No squirt guns?
That's a great idea.
Squirt gun's good. Even lasers, you know, they've well, come out with all kinds of things.
We've gotten into trouble, though, taking the guns into proper...
Yeah. I think that would be, that'd be cool. One last question before I let the ladies go from Marburger. Chris, thanks for calling. How can we help you?
Hi, Denny. We've got an office building. Well, it's a shop. And when it was built, we had carpet put down on concrete floors. And we've had it replaced once over the 30 years we've been in the building. But now I see a lot of carpet squares are popping up, and I was wondering if that's a lot easier to do than laying a big area of carpet on a concrete floor or what.
Is it general office? Is it kitchen? Is it bathroom? Where is it?
It's general office area, and right now it's got a very low nap carpet on it.
Okay. What do you think of carpet squares? They come in all sizes.
They're great. Easy maintenance, easy to replace a couple if they're stained.
Is there a good, better, best? What should Chris's, Chris, is this for the manufacturing facility? Is this my buddy, Chris?
It is.
All right. So is this at the shop or where is this?
Yes, it's at the shop.
All right. So high traffic with guys from the shop coming in?
Yes.
All right. Dirty feet, not asphalt type stains, but dirty feet from a machine type shop. What type of carpet, what type of square should it be looking like?
A walk-off carpet tile would be great to kind of get that dust and debris or whatever you have out.
So what is that?
Like what you see in entryways, maybe.
Okay. So we'd have that at the doors?
You could, depending on the size of the area, you could run it, you know, maybe 10 feet in to get enough of the traffic off, and then carpet with the less expensive carpet, the rest of it.
How do you clean it, Kim?
A vacuum.
Vacuum?
Mm-hmm. Just vacuum cleaner.
Chris, you still know how to use a vacuum cleaner?
Yes, I do.
There you go. All right. So what would you recommend to him? Just walk-off squares? Is that what you're calling them?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Hey, Chris, the address is 9999 Allisonville Road. And what's the email address? Oh, not an email address, but a website address.
EFMarburger.com.
EF Marburger, and is B-U-R?
Yes.
Yeah. There you go. Chris, thanks for calling, buddy, and good luck. Ladies, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
All right, so 9999 Allisonville Road. A good phone number for folks if they're at home right now and can write. What is the number?
317-841-7250.
One more time.
317-841-7250.
You guys are really pros. You can see how many calls we got in just a short period of time. Thank you to the WIBC listeners. You send me all these emails. I don't know. All I can do is find the pros, and I think I found the pros, and it's not a big box store. That's the thing. These are people that really deal with this every day. The best thing is I know is I got somebody to call for this dirty grout.
Absolutely.
There you go. Kim Marburger, Kelly Marburger, thanks for joining us right here on the 93 WIBC. It's good to have you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right. There you go. EF Marburger, BURGER.com. Oh, Landon. I think you're like a teenage boy enjoying these songs. This is really nice.
I just try to vibe. It feels summer. Oh, a little bit fall, I guess, today, but it's like you don't want summer to end, and it's like, you know what, we're going to get some just good vibe songs going.
That's
in here.
What we need. Hey, I want to say congratulations to my grandson. I won't give his name out, but he passed his driver's test yesterday, and he got to go out in a car by himself for the first time last night.
That's so fun. Where did you guys go for your first solo drive?
We lived on the west side. That's interesting. Mitch Foyt and I got to drive. Mitch Foyt and I went up to Easley's golf course. It was a three-hole golf course. It only had like six or eight holes. And it was roughly at Georgetown Road and 56th Street, or Kessler, 56th Street. And it was all, I mean, it was a million years ago. It was in the 60s. And we went up there in the family station wagon. And we played golf, miniature golf and three-hole golf. So. How about you? Where'd you go?
I think I drove to Walmart, and then I drove to my friend Mackenzie's house. And I remember the whole time I was like, this doesn't feel right. This doesn't feel legal.
Nobody's yelling
at me. I was so nervous, but I felt, I don't know, it feels, it's such a rite of passage. Yeah.
Allison, here we go. Allison, did you take somebody with you, or did you go by yourself?
No, this is by myself.
By yourself.
Yeah.
Terry, did your first trip, did you go by yourself?
No, took a friend.
Yeah.
And we cruised.
Cruised around town.
Knightstown. Yeah, Knightstown.
Was it a convertible?
No.
Okay, oh so you just gosh, had, no. Did you have the windows no. down and that long blonde hair going behind
no,
you?
No, Probably not. Probably the windows were down. I don't remember actually like wind blowing through my hair or anything.
I'm trying to remember your birthday's in January.
February.
Yeah, so it could be kind of cold.
Yeah, kind of cold, but you never forget that.
You really
or actually, you know, as the summer, I saw several, not as many as I used to, but several driver's ed classes. Oh, yeah. You know, the kids with the, you know, they're sitting tall, both hands on the wheel.
Do you see these new stickers they put on the back of the car? And my grandson has one that says, please be patient, student.
I like that.
I know, but if you're driving, that's embarrassing.
I think I like it because then I'm like, okay, I got to give them a little more grace because.
No, but if you're the teenager and you see that on the back, wouldn't that be embarrassing to you?
No, I'd want people to be as nice to me as possible.
I'd be embarrassed.
I see. Yeah. Maybe.
My road rage would still still get the best of me. I wouldn't care.
You wouldn't care. Yeah. Well, we cuss at you all the time. You don't even pay attention.
I can't imagine, though. I really can't in this day and age, because I was very lucky to grow up in a small town as far as, you know, taking that driver's ed class. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was very rare that you were really like in terrible traffic or
where did you learn to drive? What vehicle did you learn to drive in?
And whatever the vehicle was. I don't remember what it was. It was a driver's ed car.
Oh, okay. It wasn't the family car then.
What?
Did you drive the family car?
When it was time to drive?
When it was time to drive.
Yeah, okay. It's family car. But to grow up here in a city like Indianapolis and you're doing driver's ed, I can't.
Oh, man.
I mean, people are nuts.
Yeah.
As far as everybody around you.
How did you learn? Did your daddy teach you?
No, so I took driver's ed in Martinsville in the summer, and they had a day specifically where we had to get on the highway.
Oh, Lord.
Right. And then there was a day you went to the city, and I went to high school in the city, so... once I got my license, I just kind of had to learn, which was good. I was kind of thrown into it because then later in life, like several years later in college, I had several friends who had never driven in a city before, and they were terrified. Yeah, so, you know,
it's scary. It's just very time to drive.
How about you, Jack? What'd you learn on?
Learned on my mom's nice little family. Small
sedan.
SUV, yeah.
Oh, small SUV. Well,
did you take driver's ed?
I did. So I have a twin sister. We both took it at the same time.
Who did you have? Was one of your instructor? Was it somebody in the school? Because that was like, we had science teachers and math teachers. And that's who was teaching us.
There was an older gentleman that it was at the AAA, like driving school, I think, right off of one Carmel Drive. I just remember the one thing that really stuck with me, that highway hypnosis.
You get sleepy from, you know, it still happens.
Oh, yeah.
It still happens.
Happens to me every day.
I learned on a plumbing truck. It was an old truck. It was a 4-speed, you know, but it had a clutch, and I had to learn on a clutch, but I had a big parking lot, and I couldn't hit anything. I mean, it was like, you know how when you start working with a clutch, how you do, and one of the warehousemen helped me get that figured out, but then everything's
I think it's, you know, I know that we don't have that kind of I had a car that was a stick, and you had to learn, you know, how to do it. I hated it.
And remember when you were on a hill?
But I learned, oh my
gosh. Remember parking on a hill, try to do it?
Right. Yeah. I mean, everything about it was difficult until, you know, later on.
Yeah, Terry, now they have automatic brakes. When you take your foot off the brake, it holds it for you. So you come in. So there's a lot didn't used to have that.
Oh, we are spoiled.
We didn't have to learn on stick.
All right, the young.
You should know.
Well, I tried one time and failed.
Yeah, so. It'd
be nice to learn. Yeah.
If you were dating, Jane wanted to learn. I had an MGB, which was a sports car, and Jane wanted to learn how to drive a stick. And we were dating. And I said, okay, sure. Never, ever try to teach a date how to drive a stick.
Yeah,
ever.
That doesn't sound like a good idea.
Oh, she scared me to death, and I said something. Whew, you know, then that was it. There was no kiss goodnight that night. I'm just telling you.
But you know what? I bet you had, like we had. We had just one big long seat in the front.
Bench seat.
And so she could sit right next to you, or you could sit right next to her while she was learning.
Except that my father, Snuffy, the famous Snuffy Smith, as soon as Tommy and I started dating, there were no more bench seats in the front seat of the car, family car.
When was that? When did they go away?
In the later part of the
60s. In the later part of the 60s.
Tommy graduated in 67. I graduated in 70. But we did not have bench seats in the Smith family.
No, but even through high school, every car that everybody was driving was not a new car. So it was still bench seats.
Yeah, and those guys got to put their arms around their honey. And I didn't get a chance to do that.
Well, it's crazy now, too. Everyone learns online. The driver's ed.
That's what my granddaughter says.
Yeah.
Not the driving part, but the
instructional
part.
You still have to do some driving.
Okay.
But I mean, I think like 50-60% is online, which kind of seems.
You know what? This is why there's
scary.
So many problems. Yeah. Okay. why would you? That doesn't even make sense to me.
Yeah.
Okay.
That you're in a car learning how
to
drive.
And a lot of them don't even. A lot of kids now just don't even care to learn to drive.
They'll wait till they're 18 just to get their license without.
Yeah. Because of Uber or just.
Yeah.
I guess public transportation? I don't know.
They'd rather just be driven around.
Or, like, honestly, you don't have to drive to your friend's house anymore. You can go online and talk to them. You can FaceTime at your house. Yeah. Like, you don't
How
have to.
How are you getting to and from work?
Well, I mean, they're high school kids.
What work?
So.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean that age?
Yes, yes, yes.
But they're not waiting. So about 18 is when they'll get it then?
Yeah. That's been kind of the more popular thing. Interesting.
Wow. Isn't that fun? Anyway, the first... away from home visit by my grandson by himself, God bless them. And all you want to say is, don't speed, be safe. You know, you just wear your seatbelt. You know, thank God there's airbags in the car. But our number is 317-239-9393. We're brought to you by the Michaelis Corporation. Water, storms, fire, and wet basements. Life happens. Michaelis happens to help you through it. You give us a call, 844-FIX-INDY, but you give us a call here at the station with your questions, 317-239-9393. WIBC. I'm going to try and stay in touch with the Marburger girls, Kim and Kelly. We get a lot of questions, and you can see how quickly the phones lit up. If you got other questions, send them to me, and I'll try to get you in touch with them. But it's just grateful to know that somebody knows what's going on, because you can't always call that 800 number, and the 800 number is going to make you feel like an idiot anyway. So they didn't make me feel like an idiot. Allison, you were talking about a movie, and my first rule of movie, I'm going to have you share what you did, because it sounds like a great movie, but I never want to come away from a movie down or depressed. Tell us about this movie you guys were talking about.
Oh, we got on the subject of Zac Efron naturally during break. And yeah, he was in The Iron Claw, which came out earlier this year, and it's about the Von Erich brothers.
The wrestlers.
And if you know anything about their story, you know it's a little bit of a sad story, but it's so well done. I highly recommend it, but I mean, it's definitely not a movie where you go away with like happy-go-lucky feelings, but
see, that's what I want.
It's kind of a sweet ending. But I can't give away too much else.
Don't give away the ending.
But it's a very good movie. Just know that, yeah, it's not like a Adam Sandler type of movie. I'll just say that.
Not an Adam Sandler. You know somebody who really is good at movies is Fulton.
Hey, hi, Fulton.
Fulton, how you doing?
Hey, good morning, everyone.
How we doing?
Doing all right. How about yourself?
We're doing well. So what's new in your life, Fulton?
Well, I just heard they're going to have the Greatest Showman going to be on the musical World Tour.
Ooh.
Next year. And we lost a softball game last Saturday, but I caught the ball at the outfield. So.
Oh, wow. That's pretty cool. Yep.
And I'm doing a ukulele class now.
You're doing ukulele again?
Ukulele class, yep.
Yeah, well, you made me proud when you were playing the ukulele a couple weeks ago. And I always wanted to play guitar, and I worked it up. I actually sang at my senior, convocation.
Of course you did.
But I haven't picked up a string instrument. Do you have to worry about the pads on your fingers on a ukulele getting tough?
Sometimes I do. Yep, sometimes I do, and they want us to not do picks, like guitar picks, and they just want us to use the.
You're taking lessons?
Yep, I'm taking lessons.
Where do you take ukulele lessons?
I take ukulele lessons in Westfield Library, every Monday night at 6:30.
Oh, wow. That's so cool.
That's pretty cool. Is it a group lesson or is it an individual lesson?
It's a group lesson.
Cool.
What song are you guys working on right now?
We are working on, we have different kind of songs. We do the ones with Walk the Line, Buffalo Gals.
Do you sing like Johnny Cash? I walk the line.
Something like that.
Well, Fulton, it's always good to talk to you. Listen, you have a good week and stay out of trouble, okay?
Good luck with softball.
My mom's gonna be out of town. She's going on a plane today, so it'll be her first time.
Ooh. Wow.
So she's going to Florida.
Oh, that'll be nice. I wish I was going to Florida.
Yeah, I wish I was going to Florida. Fulton, you take care. It's always good to talk to you. That's the famous Fulton from up in Hamilton County.
Have a good week, Fulton.
What a good kid.
Yeah, he is.
JMV are pretty tight, pretty good buddies. Our number's 317-239-9393, 317-239-9393. For all of you financial planners out there, I got something from Ashley at the Salvation Army that we all need continuing education credits. there was a really neat symposium coming up, and Salvation Army presents it. It's called the Red Shield Symposium. It's a webcast that brings together professional advisors so you can learn about the latest on estate planning and hear updates on legislation that are really changing the impact of charitable gifts. This is important for all of you CFPs, for all of you financial advisors. The cost of the event is only $75, but here's the thing. Those continuing education credits that we have to do every 2 years, you can get six of those babies for $75 if you attend this thing. So learn more about it. You can go to theredshield.org, theredshield.org. You can always reach out to Ashley Alden there at Salvation Army. But really, you can't pass this up. $75, six credits for continuing ed, and you can get up to speed on what's going on with charitable gifts. Theredshield.org.
Speaking of Salvation Army, Radiothon is months away. I think they started their first meeting this week.
Did they really?
So December 14th will be Radiothon. Of course, it'll be at Sullivan Hardware again. And I'm already getting some bands together. So if anyone's interested, you can reach out to us on Facebook, Home and Garden Indiana. Send me a little note. We're starting to schedule some bands.
That really is the best part. You know that.
Yeah, we have a lot of local talent who donate their time and very grateful. And it's always it always helps a day move a little quicker. Sometimes that 36 hours gets to you.
There we go. Hey, I think we got time to squeeze in a quick call here. We've got Jeff. Hey, Jeff, how are you?
I'm doing good this morning. How are you guys doing?
We're doing good. You got crabgrass, do you?
Well, I treated early in the spring, and I must have gotten a batch of treater that just didn't work or something, because I'm having crabgrass like crazy in my backyard. I was wondering if I can do something now, or is it best just to wait till spring?
Well, if you're going to do it in spring, you got to get the pendimethalin down. You got to get it before it germinates. Now that it's germinated, you got to deal with it. And that's the tough part, Jack.
Yeah, but I think easiest way to take care of that would be some of those kind of lawn crabgrass killers, just a hose end attachment. I know I've had crabgrass take over parts of my front and backyard.
Right.
And then, you know, just kind of a few applications of that. I noticed I had more crabgrass in my yard than I originally thought. But
can you do that now?
Yeah, he could do that now.
Jeff, is it along the sidewalks or along the driveway where you're seeing most of the crabgrass?
No, well, my backyard, it's just taken over like the whole middle part of the yard. I mean, it's bad.
Jack's right. There was hose in sprayers, and just go down the chemical aisle at the hardware store, at the home and garden stores, and they'll tell you, it'll say crabgrass killer, and that's what you want. And it's very gene specific, and it's not going to hurt your regular thin blade grass. It's that broadleaf grass.
Crabgrass,
that just
makes
everybody grouchy. Jeff, thanks for the phone call. Our number is 317-239-9393. We're brought to you by the Michalis Corporation. We're grateful for their sponsorship. Sully's somewhere overseas on a crew enjoying himself. Maybe we'll get him to call in here. Probably not. But it's the Home and Garden Show right here on 93 WIBC.
Some folks say that grown-up men are still just little boys. That really the only difference is the price of our toys. We go for macho symbols like guns and running shoes. Pickup trucks, hunting ducks, and power tools, power tools.
A beautiful Saturday in central Indiana. You're listening to WIBC's The Home and Garden Show. Brought to you by the Michalis Corporation. Water storms, fire, and wet basements. Life happens. Michalis happens to help you through it. 844-FIX-INDY, all the way from the foundation to the rooftop. They take care of everything. You give them a call, 844-FIX-INDY. Ladies, we are in the middle of August. What happened to summer?
Well, early August.
Well, it's the 10th.
But yeah, it is, we were talking about that last hour. It's just, summer is just getting shorter and shorter, especially with kids going back to school. And I mean, some
the
people are in their
fair's
second.
On.
Yeah, the
fair's
second
on.
Week.
And here's what else: you just notice it because it's getting darker soon.
It
and
is.
I really have noticed it like in the last week.
Last night, it really hit me.
It did. Last night was one of those nights. Uh-huh. I was like, "Wow, it's just 9 o'clock," and I already am in somewhat the dark.
So, do you like longer nights? Because I hate longer nights. I mean, I would rather have the sun go down at 7:30 or 8 o'clock.
Well, you also go to bed at 7:30.
I get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. It's dark when I get up.
But why?
There's nothing better to
because
me.
Because there's stuff to do.
9 o'clock
no,
in the sun setting.
4 o'clock in the morning?
What are you doing at 4 o'clock in the morning?
Okay, I get up.
Okay.
SSS.
Shower. Got it. We got
all right.
It.
Okay. I eat breakfast, head out to the barn. I do the water project. I have a water project where I'm working with plasmas and stuff. Anyway, I do my scientific experiments
at
in the morning.
At 4 o'clock in the morning?
5 o'clock.
5 o'clock. And yeah. You must do them at 5?
That's when I refill the bottle. You can do them. You have to. It's like 8 to 14 hours between...
bottle feeding?
Sort of bottle feeding.
Okay, next.
Mick Glant, Dr. Glant, I went to school with me, and he taught me how to deal with plasma and water for energy water. And I've been doing it for 4 or 5 years, and I can't get out of it. So then I go out to the barn, got stuff to do out in the barn.
Like what?
Like, work on the lawnmowers and the tractors.
So I'm seeing no correlation how this is a 4 o'clock project.
Because I want to walk with Mackie by 6:30. So
why can't you walk first?
Because it's dark.
And then you have the whole day. No, I mean, at 6:30.
We walk at 6:30.
Right.
When the
get
sun's
up
coming
at a normal time, like 6 o'clock or 6:30.
Because I got all my chores to do.
Plasma is best dealt with in the morning.
But thank you,
Jack. See, that's what I'm missing.
That's what we're learning in this conversation.
I understand with farmers because there's
right.
There's several animals.
They got to be fed.
They
got
to be
schedule.
Fed. There's lots to do.
Right.
People who work in manufacturing, they have to get up early. Totally get that. I just... By choice. You're retired. And you get up at 4
have
o'clock.
I had a paper route when I was a kid. I got up at 4 o'clock to deliver papers. Then I went to work, and I had to be at the shop by 6, so I got up early for that. I mean, I've always gotten up early.
I'm always jealous of the early morning people.
When was your first class in college? Mine was always 7 o'clock. When was your first class in college?
In college?
Yeah.
It just depends. Probably 9.
Did you ever have a 7 o'clock class?
Probably, yeah.
7 Never. O'clock is absurd. Yeah.
I gotta say,
in high school, it started at
getting up for 25 years to do mornings.
Yeah,
at 4 in the morning to be on at 5 or even 3:30. That alarm went off. Somebody told me once. They said, "Oh, you know what? When you're done with this, it'll be real easy getting into another schedule."
Was it?
And they were absolutely.
Really?
It took maybe a week or two, and then then you were Zoom. You were like, okay, give me 8 a.m.
Yeah,
well, 7 a.m.
I call my mom my mom's up early too because she was a plumber's wife. I call her between 5:30 and 5:45.
Wow.
We talk for 15 or 20 minutes.
Yeah, when I did the morning show for a couple of years, when I first started, someone was like, oh, you'll get used to getting up that early. I never once did. It's just my brain is not a morning person, and I'm jealous because my sister has always been a morning person. Not 4 a.m., but probably 6, 5,
Okay, one of our listeners, Dr. Glant, just sent me a text. 4 a.m. GANS. GANS is a type of energy water. That's the way to start the day. So that plasma water, that's Dr. Mick sending me the message. See, he gets up early, too. Of course, he's in Colorado, though. That's different, I guess.
I'm just baffled that someone by choice would get up at 4 a.m.
Yeah.
But,
fairness,
each their own. It works for you, Dave.
I am really tired. I'm in bed by 8:30 or 9 o'clock. Now, you guys are still partying, right?
I like night.
Yeah.
You like night?
I like night.
My brain works better.
I like television at night.
No.
I like maybe 1 o'clock.
Throw out the TV.
I like the peacefulness of the night, but I also love the peacefulness of the morning. But I'm just saying I've turned into a night person.
All right, so what's your favorite television show?
When I'm watching at 1 o'clock, Bob Newhart.
1
and then
o'clock?
I fall asleep.
Is Suzanne Plachette?
Yeah. And it puts me right to sleep. That's the last show I see.
Allison, what's your favorite television program?
Oh, to go to sleep to?
Well, just what do you watch at night?
I watch The Office a lot because I've seen that show so much. It's just good to put on the background.
Right.
I also have the Andy Griffith Show on a lot.
Really? So you know about Opie.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. All right, Jack. I'm not going to leave you out. Do you watch television at night?
I do like to fall asleep to something.
What?
Recently, it's been Simpsons.
That's a good one.
Do you remember when we used to think
nothing you have to think hard about or get into.
Or
just a
scary
30-minute, fun something.
Don't make me think about life problems.
I don't want to watch true crime.
We used to think that the Simpsons were sarcastic and everything. It's just mainstream conversation now.
Yes, it is, Marge.
All right, we've got to get back to these calls. 239-9393. It's the Home and Garden Show. We hope Pat's enjoying his vacation. I sort of miss the guy. You guys are doing your best to beat up on me, but it doesn't hold a candle to Patrick
Gerard. We can try harder if you'd like.
No, let's go. Let's talk to Scott the Lawn Guy. How are you, sir?
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Good.
Hey, before I get to my comment, I want to ask Jack about how do I grow blueberries? I'm a total failure on that.
Oh, I love blueberries. There's nothing better than
acidic soil.
You're not the only one. Yeah, I think the key there is making sure you have that acidic soil. In Indiana with the clay, we all have that more kind of naturally alkaline soil.
Yeah, if you get north of Lafayette, maybe up towards Monticello, you got half a chance. But down here, it's not you, Scott.
If you could do it in a container and then keep that container, you know, a big, large.
What do you use to get the pH?
So Hollytone or Berrytone, that kind of acidic fertilizer, yeah. But organic since you're going to eat it.
You got to lower the pH if you're going to be successful, Scott.
You know, that surprises me just because of the acid rain. I mean,
we don't have acid rain in Indiana because we're burning that low sulfur coal if we're burning any of it at all. So, all right, let's get to your real question.
And then on the crabgrass.
Yeah.
The crabgrass is my enemy as a grass cutter. It just crawls all over the sidewalk, does not grow up at all, and just extends my trimming requirements. But if you read on the bag of the Scott's Halts, it says specifically apply in the spring and the fall. And then, so really the problem is on crabgrass is money. People aren't wanting to spend $200 twice a year on crabgrass preventer. And they think their fertilizer guy is taking care of that. But no, you didn't give him any money.
you got a sort That's of a soft point. Spot. You're a little sensitive about this, Scotty.
That's right. That's right.
So
it's floppy.
All right. Well, so does germination for crabgrass takes place in the fall, too?
There's a spring and a fall crabgrass. I actually have a side service where I put the halts down, and this mid-August is exactly the time to put it down.
Wow.
And you got to do that for a year before the crabgrass goes away. You got to do it now, and then the spring, and then in the fall, you might be getting it down.
So these are like hydrangeas. Some of them you trim in the spring. Some of them you trim in the fall. I did not know there were two species of crabgrass. I just thought it was all crabgrass. You're telling me there's two different ones?
Well, you only see the foxtails in the fall. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You're blowing Denny's mind right now. Yeah. I can see it. No, really?
I'm a master gardener, son. I never heard this before.
Oh, my gosh.
It'll work a little bit, but really the solution is just spending the money and applying it twice a year, spring and fall. Same way with the bugs. All those bare spots are bugs. People don't want to drop $200 on that either.
What do you use now besides, we used to use diazinon. What are you using now for bugs?
Whatever is granule, whatever. And okay. Then I also use the here's another tip.
You're just full of yourself, Scotty. I like this. Fire away.
You know the concentrated insecticide stuff.
Yeah.
You don't need mosquito, Mike. Just spray that everywhere, on the house, on the deck, on the trees, the shrubs, the grass, foundation, everywhere, and do it about monthly.
Will I grow a third thumb?
I could, I guess.
Yeah.
And Scott, what's your business called, if anyone's curious?
It's Scott's Lawn Service.
Easy enough. Yeah. Do you have a website or Facebook, Google it?
Nope, I'm full.
You're full. Hey, well, here's the thing. Has Scott's Lawn Care got after you? Because if your name's Scott, you can get away. Have you got any cease and desist orders from them?
I don't advertise the chemicals.
Oh, I see.
You have to have a certification in the state to apply chemicals commercially.
Okay. Scott, appreciate your phone call. I learned something.
A few customers there on that one.
Yeah.
But hey, like the show, guys.
It's all about Jack. We got Jack. You got Scott. We got Jack.
Well, thank you for the tips. I mean, we learned a lot.
We did learn a lot. Huh. Our number is 317-239-9393. Give us a call right here on 93 WIBC. I know you guys are all excited that Craft Corner is coming up. It'll be in the next segment. We got a little bit of time here. We're going to talk with Jack about some things that have been showing up in my email. I get a lot of emails, denny@wibc.com. A lot of people have my cell phone number, and they text me all the time. But, Jack, we've got some indoor activities we can be doing. We've got some outdoor activities. Let's start with the home. What's going on with house plants and indoor activities right now with our house plants?
Well, I think house plants, most house plants would have gone through a stage of growth by now. So some would be getting ready to flower. Some would be kind of hardening off that new growth they've pushed out. But really just kind of same thing you see outside where some outdoor plants look a little tired. Indoor plants can do the same. So it's just a nice time to kind of clean up the dirt, clean up the plants.
So those ones that are outside, you know, whether it's the impatiens, coleus, geraniums, wax begonias, we can bring those inside. We can overwinter in the, on the inside?
Yeah, so you still have plenty of time to keep them growing outside, but now would be the time if you want to try to get something to overwinter.
How do you
overwinter.
Get them in? Do you, so you're doing starts, are you digging roots, or how are you getting starts inside?
So I would do cuttings.
Okay.
And there are so many easy, you know, ways now to propagate those. That powder rooting hormone is easy.
They used to have liquid, but I'm with you. Dump them in the water, hit them in the powder rooting hormone, put them down. That really does promote it.
It does. And it really takes away a lot of that kind of effort in almost a foolproof way to keep your annuals going longer than just the summer.
Do you guys have spring bulbs in yet? I mean, do you... No, a lot of people are ordering them now.
People are asking. Yeah. They should be coming, I think, first week of September.
Okay.
But definitely, if you want those spring blooms like the crocus, daffodils, that would be the time to plant in the fall.
What's funny is, isn't that the sign of spring? All of a sudden, we'll see one little crocus pop up. And sometimes it's even through the snow as it's coming through. Now, this is 6, 7, 8 months away. But then the daffodil patches keep coming up in big
in mass
in herds. I mean, it's like they're herds. Do those bulbs duplicate down below in the soil? How do they propagate?
They do. If you don't have a critter kind of digging them up, they do continue to multiply those bulbs just at that base in the ground, and then it can help, you know, at some point to go in, try to split some of that up if they start to chug themselves out, but you have a long time.
A lot of people have given up on the gardens. You know, the weeds have caught in. They, you know, the trick with gardens is you weed a lot the first couple of weeks, and then you just stay after it.
You stay on top of it,
and but people are about giving up on that thing at this point.
And I don't blame them.
Yeah. Let's talk about onions. A lot of people don't know really how to harvest or how to dry out their onions. You want to help us out with that with onions?
That one I'm not as familiar with.
Well, the tops, I think if I remember right, we want to get them after the tops yellow and fall. But the trick is not to eat them right away, to let them cure a little bit in a dry space.
That'd be that paper bag trick.
That paper bag
dry
trick.
Dry paper bag, sealed shut.
Right.
And then just put it in a spot you're not going to forget. I know I did some potatoes at one point last year, tried to bring some inside to kind of save. Boy, did they smell terrible about them.
Here's the thing about onions. You've got to get some of the fluid out of them, or they will really be just almost too stout for you, even for you people that have smoked your whole life and think that you like onions. Some of the onions that are a little bit too, I don't want to say ripe, but they haven't had the moisture out of them. You'll know that they're free of moisture when they're fully cured. In the neck of it, you can see that it's really, really dry, maybe even starting to paper out a little bit.
Yeah, just like what you'd see kind of approaching a onion in the grocery store.
Exactly. That's really what you're looking for. All right, let's go to the yard. We've got the lawns, woody ornamentals, and fruits. Give us some coaching on that, Jack.
Yeah, so now would be the time to do some pruning. The one thing you want to avoid right now, I know a lot of people come in thinking their plants look stressed. They didn't fertilize it all over the summer. They want to put something down on it now, but you're really forcing growth at the wrong time of year if you try to put on that fertilizer now.
So do you stay, just try to get some water to them? Or
water it now and then hold off on the fertilizer another month or so. And then once those trees start to recede back into the ground is when you want to get that fertilizer down.
Is there any of the, you know, the Holytone products? I'm a really big fan of that. Is there anything that we can put down that will not promote growth, that will promote I'm going to say root stabilization, or that will just promote good health of the plant? Is there any Holytone that we can use for that?
Well, so the Holytone would work, even the Biotone. So Biotone, I think putting the Biotone down is all about getting the roots established. So if you had fertilized, let's say, in the spring with Holytone, could certainly do that Biotone now. It's just going to get the roots stronger for spring.
Yeah, it's not too soon now for us to talk about webworms and bagworms.
Ooh, not at all.
What's your philosophy? I've had everybody say, start a bonfire, burn them out.
Yeah.
And I've had people say, no, just wait for them to come out and or get back inside. They're going to come out. They get back into their little
cocoons.
So go ahead and trim them off, hand prune.
I think hand pruning is always the best. And I know you get to, you know, the stage where some trees are way too big to get all the way up there, but it's really hard to treat those after you see those cocoons on there because they've created a little shell for themselves. So there are chemical sprays you can spray, but I think a systemic in the spring to get it absorbed in, so it's kind of boosting that plant's defense for fall, and then hand removing this time of year.
I get a lot of my information from the Hamilton County Master Gardeners Association. They really keep a lot up, but they always refer people to the Purdue Extension website. If you have not done that, just do the Google machine and do Purdue Extension garden questions, lawn questions, whatever. They keep that up to date, and you know they're always on top of the new stuff, just like we had the blight last year. On you know very specific evergreens, they were all over that.
By the time we were hearing a lot about it, we could go refer to them. They'd already
smelled it out.
Exactly.
It out. All right, it's the Home and Garden Show. Our number is 239-9393. But when we come back, we have the very, very famous Craft Corner, Allison Lemons, Woo! Terry Stacy, and guest appearance by Jack Phipps of Allisonville Home and Garden. Right here on 93 WIBC. All right. Here on the Home and Garden Show, we have different segments that we enjoy. We're going live right now on Facebook Live for Craft Corner with the very famous Terry Stacy, Allison Lemons, and guest appearance by Jack Phipps.
Yay!
Hey!
Jack
excited
is here.
Excited to be helping.
All yep. right.
And our thanks, by the way, to Kevin's Candles and Crafts, who sponsor, out of Greenfield, who sponsor Craft Corner. Thank you, Kevin. Today we're going to do something really simple and really easy, and this is just a fun project. It's called Bubble Paint.
Yeah.
I already love it. And basically, you're going to need your craft or your cardstock paper, a little bit heavier, any size you like. I think something big because we're going to blow bubbles. You're going to need some cups, plastic cups. These are just your 9-ounce, shorter type of cups, and then you're also going to need your dishwashing liquid, which you probably already have, straws, and also then get out your acrylic paint in all different colors. Ooh. You're also going to need just a little bit of water, and you're going to need one tablespoon stuff. Okay, so here's what we're going to need. It's an actual 1-1-1 ratio. You're going to use one. Let me clean this real quick. Hold on. Hold on, everybody. In fact, the kids can get started. Why don't we let the kids get started?
Okay.
Yeah. So once you get your 1 tablespoon of dishwashing detergent, 1 tablespoon of water, and 1 tablespoon of acrylic paint in your cup, mix it up real good with your straw, and then you're going to put your straw into the paint cup, and you're going to bubble it up. You're going to blow. Do it, boys.
Do we want
girls.
It to come over the side of the cup?
So we blow.
You want it to come up over, the bubbles to come up over.
Like chocolate milk.
Bring it all the way up. Bring it up. Go hard. Blow harder. Stop. Once you've stopped and it's up there, go ahead and then take your straw out, lay it on the table, and you're going to scoop this off onto the paper. Okay. Oh, you got one big one. Do it again.
Ooh, I did not scoop very well.
You can pour it. You can touch it just to the side. There you go. And then let it be. Let it drop.
Allison's
Boom.
Just getting one
Perfect.
Big bubble.
That's bubble art.
And
Wait,
once
do it again. Sorry.
Okay, keep going.
That looks good.
Once you create your bubble art using all your different colors, it turns out to look like this. Okay, most of all, it's just fun. But the bubbles then dry and pop onto the craft paper, onto your cardstock.
All right,
Allison.
Allison's got the green or the yellow. Make
and
your magic
pretty.
There, Ellie.
So what do I do?
So you can do what you're getting ready to do, but it won't make as pretty of a bubble.
Okay.
I was experimenting. So then you're going to take your knife.
Yep.
And you're just
mine.
Going to put it over and drop it.
Oh, wait.
Yours is not dropped. Whoa, we got to do it again.
Yikes.
Do it again, little one.
We're learning.
Look at Jack. See what Jack
wow,
has done?
Wow, that's a huge one.
Yeah. And so we're going to give, what color would you like next?
The neon, please.
The neon pink, the neon yellow.
The yellow.
Oh,
the one that Allison's keeps screwing up. Allison, what are you doing?
You got to go higher.
Odd green.
She's got to go higher.
And I believe the ratio is 1 to 1 to 1.
1 to 1 to 1. 1 to 1 to 1.
There we go.
Okay, let's get you a little bit of neon yellow. Is that what you said?
Yes,
please. Neon yellow.
I'll take any.
All right, so
this will create something really fun for everybody. I promise you that everybody will have fun doing it. It's bubble paint, and if you want to look it up, this is not anything I just made up.
Look, I noticed as it continues to
All right,
to
now, Allison,
here,
you should be able to
get a little more intense color.
It's a little more intense.
If
Isn't
you're
cool?
if you're joining us on Facebook
How's Allison
Live,
doing?
Allison's blowing up the bubbles, but by the time she gets them to the paper, they're all go back down.
She can barely believe it.
She's snapping my bubbles are.
Your bubbles are
I'm
huge.
I'm so talented.
I will say, you now scoop it off.
Scoop.
And let it just fall off the knife. Okay.
Come on.
Allison.
I thought you said
just
children
like
could do this.
Well, I mean, look at Jackson. It's great.
Yeah, my son.
Jackson
Wait,
is
here we go.
Right here.
Right. Here we go.
Okay, well,
you
now,
see it, Denny?
Hurry.
See
it. Drop it.
Drop.
No, just let
Wait, do I fling
Allison,
it down?
Allison, just fling it
how
down.
Just how do you mess it down? Up? Well, I feel bad for you. I don't know what
Allison,
to tell you. I can't
you're really,
really
embarrassing
her.
Us.
She's my one student that I always have problems with.
That's right.
I don't
know. All right, Jack's ready to go with the yellow now.
Scoop that up. Stir it all up together.
I'm going to get a little blue in there, but it happens.
Yeah.
Okay, so that'll make it green.
Oh, now you're getting it on your clothes.
Oh,
no, wait, hold on.
Oh, Allison. We're not putting that on. I'm sorry. We're not going to put that on the video. Okay, we're back.
Yeah. Oh, she's got green on her. What are we going to do about that? We got to help you. I've got my Tide stick.
Allison, move your arms out. Push your arms way out in front of you.
So what could we do with this finished bubble art?
And once you have the bubble art done, you can just do, you can do like what I've done and what Jack is doing. It can all be all different colors.
Like Allison's doing
or
as well.
Joe Camille.
I've forgotten you're even over there now.
Joe Camille, who just had his 59th birthday, just said, "This is a Hunter Biden painting class." Yeah. Way to go, Joe. I like that. That's my type of humor. And happy birthday, brother.
Or you could turn these into flowers. You can do just a few different squares and then actually paint stems and leaves. But I think the kids will love it. They'll have a good time when they're at your house. And the bubbles turn out to be... I see you from my right, Miss Allison.
Wow.
She's
Allison,
saying this.
Yours
she
is
just said
terrible.
Average. Look, what?
I think
look
it's
Jack.
A, I think it's a
look
green.
Look at Jack.
I think it's a green.
You think it's a green?
Because look.
Let's get her some blue. Yeah.
Let's see if she can screw up
straw.
The blue. Use your own straw.
Yeah. Use your straw.
I guarantee you it's the green. It has nothing to do with my talents.
Oh, yeah. Look how patient he is. Look at him blowing the perfect bubbles. Here he is. Look how good of a blower he is now. Look what he's done. Now he's going to take the knife. He's going to just scoop it off, and it lands, and boom! Just
how come like Jack
wait,
is so good? Okay, now,
better.
Don't screw that up, Allison. That's good. Let's see if Allison can do this one.
Okay.
Okay, there you go. You're too quick. There you go. There you go.
So it was the green this whole time.
No, it was you.
Look at it. It's perfect now.
It was you.
Are you kidding me?
No, I'm not kidding you. You were terrible.
So don't use green. But look, that's bubble and that's paint. I did it.
She did it.
Picasso.
She did it.
Would you look
she
at Jack over here? Jack's on his fourth piece of paper.
Yeah, and also look at his. He has no green. So don't use the color green. It will ruin it.
This has been commissioned by a fan online.
See, already you can certainly buy this for something. He'll put a price on it. It's
See?
Real
Allison,
art.
I'm not sure I'd brag about that.
It's the green, I'm telling you.
It almost looks a little...
I think it's fun. Bubble art, and you can Google it if you didn't get any of it here, if you're driving and you don't see it. We hope you'll tune in. Thanks to everybody who is. I know it's a busy, beautiful Saturday.
All right, say goodnight, ladies.
Well, goodnight.
Enjoy
goodnight.
Your craft.
Yeah,
thank you, Kevin's
craft.
Candles and Crafts, for sponsoring Craft Corner.
Thank
and
you for,
all for of
putting
you
for up
watching.
With our craft.
Yeah, thank you. Okay.
Well, there you go.
I thought it went well. Everybody.
You went well. Everybody else did. Allison.
Really good. I love what you've done.
I think you ought to put that up in your office.
Listen.
Nobody... Look at Jack. Jack's going spastic
Jack's
over
Jack.
Here.
Look at Jack. He's great. Oh. Look at Jack. He's so artistic. I get it. I get it. I get it.
We get it.
Not all of us can be Jack. Not all of us can blow our bubbles and
but,
scoop them well.
Listen, whoa.
Some of us.
This seems like it's deep seated.
It's
like
the Home
maybe
and Garden
blow
Show.
Craft
Corner brought to you by
child.
Kevin. Candles
and
crap
I feel like a problem.
Greenfield,
you
Indiana.
Need time out.
Right here on 93 WIBC.
Time out, please.
Nobody will ever convince me that breakdancing is an Olympic sport.
Not like that.
I'm sorry. It just doesn't make it. Well, it makes sense. I mean, it's fun, but good heavens. Is the rumba and ballroom dancing an Olympic event?
Yeah. The Macarena going for gold this year.
Awesome. You know who would know all about this, Olympic events and dancing and breakdancing, is JMV. Hey, Johnny, how are you?
No, you're not enjoying the breakdancing and the Paris Olympics, Denny?
No, I'm not. I'm sorry. You know, we are getting ready to talk about the Asian jumping worm, though, and now that's sort of exciting for a home and garden guy.
Yeah, I always thought it was amazing in Footloose, Denny, when nobody was allowed to dance. Remember, there was a rule, there was a law against dancing.
Oh, yeah, and they had to go across the railroad tracks to the other side of the county.
Yeah. They had the prom to have the dance, and then they had all these dudes coming out of the woodwork that were like professional dancers, and one of them was a break dancer. It was like, he was like the best break dance you've ever seen, yet he wasn't allowed to dance, you know, in that particular town. That was always amazing to me. So,
you know, what I really liked about that,
never do.
That one scene where they were doing the chicken, I Need a Hero, and they were on the tractors, and a shoelace got caught, and he was terrified. He was ready to jump off 100 yards ahead, and yet he won that just because he was stupid and couldn't get his shoelace untied.
He was stupid. Could he get his shoelace off? I thought, I always wanted to break dance. I never could do it. I wanted to moonwalk. First time I saw Michael Jackson moonwalk on Motown 25 back in, 1983, I think. He moonwalked, and like the world was just absolutely floored about that particular dance move, and I never could do it.
Have you and your wife ever taken ballroom dancing lessons together?
No, me?
Yeah, you.
Why did you ask that seriously?
I mean, you're the only one married to your wife. Did you take ballroom dancing?
No, I never would think about. Yeah, I don't even know if I've ever been in a ballroom, Denny.
When we were younger,
I don't think I've ever seen John in full pants. I was a basketball star.
John, some of our friends were taking ballroom dancing, so they convinced Jane and me to do it. So we went down to the Arthur Murray Dance Studio, and I got this wonderful teacher. Her name was Miss Bridget, as I understand it. Yeah. She is still an instructor. And she liked everything that I was doing, and I was doing everything right. Jane had a guy, and I think his name was Arturo, but I'm not sure. And he was so critical of Jane. We lasted about two lessons. I was on top of the world because I was doing great and was getting all these compliments, and Jane was getting ripped. So how long do you think the dance lessons left?
Not very long, right? No. I mean, for you, yeah, you could have, like Fred Astaire Jr.
Oh, you better believe it. Give you a compliment when you're dancing? That's right.
No disco dancer for you back in the day, Denny?
No. I had the suit. I had the leisure suit. You know, I really had a lime green leisure suit.
Of
by
course.
The way, of course. Alice, what do you mean? Of course.
Lime green leisure suits. I love it, Denny.
Allison has been fighting green all day. She didn't do very well with her bubble paint. We got a couple minutes, John. Tell me what's going on tonight on B105.
Well, we'll do all requests Saturday night per usual. I don't even know what we're doing yet. We kind of just make it up as we go along. We'll do that. And then, of course, tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. on The Fan, you've got the Colts pregame huddle. It is the first preseason game for the Colts and the Broncos, 10 a.m. with me, Joe Wrights, Bill Brooks, and Jeffrey Gorman in Touchdown Town tomorrow morning at 10 a.m.
Hey, tomorrow they've got the Colts mini cheerleaders. I've got a little six-year-old friend. She and her mom are going to be down there. They have to be down there at 7:30 for that game to practice. And so the Colts mini cheerleaders, which are the little girls, they're going to be out cheerleading. So give them a cheer for me, Johnny.
You know, it's great. It's great too. It's great to see people be able to go to those games, the preseason games.
Absolutely.
A lot of people that don't get to go during the regular season get to go like the day like tomorrow. But nope, it should be fun. Great weekend, great weather, Denny. It's always great to talk with you, buddy.
What's the best number to call you guys, B105?
317-681-1057.
1057. I love it, John. It's good to hear it. It's like old-time radio. Thanks for joining us, brother. You take care of yourself,
you
okay?
Guys. All right. Have a great day.
We'll see you guys. Yeah, that's JMV. God, one of the best sportscasters ever. I just enjoy listening to him, and he's got a photographic memory. You cannot stump the chump.
One of the best humans, really, too. He's just a nice guy.
I wonder what he looks like in long pants.
I
think we all wonder that. It's the Home and Garden Show. When we come back, we've got plenty of time for your calls now. I think we've got all of our nonsense out of the way. Allison's got her laundry done after she spilled green paint all over herself.
I had a Tide pen, thank goodness.
Did it work?
Yeah, I'm now covered in bleach dots all over my shirt, but I think it'll work.
93 WIBC, it's the Home and Garden Show. Get on board right now, 239-9393, right here on WIBC.
Well, some folks say that grown-up men are still just little boys, but really the only difference is the price of our toys. We go for macho symbols like guns and running shoes,
pickup trucks, hunting ducks, and power tools, power tools, power tools,
power tools. All right, it's afternoon in the great state of Indiana. Luck of the longitude puts us in the eastern daylight time zone. By the way, do you meetings where they quote things in Universal Time, U2C, UTC? Do you get those messages?
All the time.
Oh, I mean, Terry.
For you too?
Yeah, on my Apple Watch every day.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
On our Apple Watch.
Okay, that went well.
I don't even know. Okay. This is the Home and Garden Show.
This is the Home and Garden Show. Okay, do you believe in UFOs? Jack, do you believe in UFOs?
Yes.
I believe that. I don't think I'm seeing a UFO when I see a shooting star go through the sky, but I, like you had said, believe there's something out there.
There's got to be something out there. Allison?
Yeah, this universe is way too big for us to even comprehend. There has to be other things.
I agree with you. I talked to Landon, but he's going to have to country music affiliation here. So do you believe in UFOs?
Oh, for sure.
Oh, for sure. Oh, that was just...
Yeah.
Take your time. Take your time, Landon.
Nah. Think it over.
Nah. And the famous Terry Stacey, you said absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I've seen them.
Remember they found one last year in Mexico.
Oh,
that's right.
They were buried.
Yeah, they were buried.
Mummified. Oh, the buried mummified one.
What is that guy's last name? Steve is his first name, but he's...
Jobs.
No, not that.
Steve.
He's gone.
The alien.
He's gone. Hey, we're taking your...
Funny, the alien's name is named Steve.
Steve.
Yeah. Oh, there's such a great movie... about an alien that they pick up, that these guys, Paul
one of
the
hilarious. Best,
it's the funniest alien movie you'll ever watch, and you'll fall in love with him. You'll love Paul. Have you seen Paul?
No.
Oh my gosh.
Is it better than
Seth Rogen.
Is it better than E.T.?
Oh yes.
See, okay.
I mean, for my age, E.T. I loved and will always love, but this newer Paul thing, it's not even really new anymore.
If we ever really do find aliens, do you think they'll look like Paul or
E.T.?
I hope so. Or do you think they'll look like the ones from like the actual Alien movies, where they're like, you know, hug your face and?
I think if they're here, they look like us.
There are a
Somebody
lot of.
Somebody did say we all come from the same stardust, which is a stupid little thing, but chances are, you know, if we're all from one Big Bang, we're all gonna look.
Yeah,
that's somewhat similar.
There's a whole these people with UFOlogy, but they're hybrids where there's UFO DNA in certain women who claim that their eggs have been harvested and then they've been grown and then I believe in the UFO process or theory and said, but then they get off in the giggle weeds and I don't know how to respond to all that.
Is it the alien babies that bothers you?
Yeah, I understand how it could have happened, but that's a lot of technology
that you don't go there. You won't
having
go to
a medical
that
procedure.
Next...
I will listen, but scientifically, I'm thinking, boy, she must have had her eyes closed or something. You know,
it happens when they take you up with them into the spacecraft.
Yeah, when you
and
listen,
then they do, then you have the thing, and then you know while you're sleeping,
right?
There you, and then you wake up, and then you're back in your bed,
and some
or
of the,
in a cornfield.
Or sometimes in a cornfield,
not
but
in
mostly
a cornfield.
In a bed.
You
it's
wake up in a cornfield
in a crop circle.
Yeah, yep.
Sometimes.
Thanks, Jack. I was trying to get to the bottom
different.
Of this.
Always different.
Giggle
always
weeds. Different.
Yeah, all right.
We're there.
Okay.
Hey, we better get back on track and help Linda with some roots. Linda, roots problem?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. We live in a neighborhood that has a lot of wooded areas between the homes. And we have a lot of locust trees that are getting tall and storm damaged. We've cut down a number of them. But they have these invasive roots that just run underneath, and they're sprouting up everywhere in our lawn. We've tried Roundup and brush killer. Do you have any ideas on something that can kill these roots?
Okay, so
gasoline.
No. So you're saying do not use gasoline, Linda. Allison was just she's not good with green paint. She's not good with gasoline either.
No. I don't know that I trust her anymore.
Yeah, I know.
You know.
All right, so are the roots above ground? Are they penetrating the ground, or are you just seeing the sprouts?
They're underground. And
okay,
we
good.
We pulled some out in the mulch, and I mean, they can be as long as the
huge.
Side of the house.
All right, so you have to outlast them. And what we normally recommend is using a snow shovel or something and spraying with glyphosate, Roundup, and you just have to stay at them. If you pull them... Jack, doesn't that stimulate growth? If you pull them, then we
it's
get too bad.
It's basically pruning it back,
And we don't want to do that because pruning promotes the growth. So you just sort of have to poison them continuously, and they'll eventually give it up. Now, if you think you can cut the main root going back to the where the tree was, you can try and do that and pull them out. I was never successful with that. We just, Pat talked me into just, he said, spray them, Denny. Spray them the next week, spray them the next week. And I think I went 2 months before I really made a dent in it at all.
Okay, so what you're saying with the snow shovel, though, can you explain that to me again?
Yeah, take an old snow shovel, and then you're going to cut a U out of it. The most of them are plastic now. You cut a U out of it, and you slide that over where the sprout is coming out of the ground. And then you shoot towards the part that does not have the U in it, and that way the glyphosate does not get on anything else. The glyphosate will kill grass. If they're, I'm assuming they're coming through grass and not mulch, right?
Well, they're coming through both. But
on the mulch, at mulch you don't need the snow shovel. When you get to anything, you know, that is organic that you want to keep, you can't kill it.
Okay. All right, so just using the Roundup, there's no other magic killer.
Unfortunately, no.
I'm looking at the magic man over here, Jack Phipps from Allisonville Home and Garden by Sullivan. No, there isn't, unfortunately.
I think make sure you're not cutting it back, even with the lawnmower, if it's in the yard, because that leaf needs to stay on there for that Roundup to really take effect.
Okay. All right, very good. Thank you for your help.
You sound like a good student. It sounds like you get it and you're going to do it, because if you start pulling them or if you start clipping them, you're going to have a mess, okay?
They just come back. It doesn't matter if you pull them, they just
come
back.
That's right. Yeah, you just got to kill them. Thanks, Linda. Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Bye-bye. Allison says, good luck. Don't listen to me. No gasoline. Did you really tell him to put gasoline on that?
I guess we'll never know.
Matches were next.
Boy, oh boy.
It's a valid answer.
239-9393. Next up, we've got Lori. Hey, Lori.
Hi, guys. Listen, I was wondering if you know of where we can have a radon test here in Martinsville. Is there someone that does it locally?
I'm sure there is, but you can buy the radon tests at most hardware stores, and then you just mail them in.
Allison is Googling real quick. Hold on.
She's
going to get an answer. She's Googling.
She's known as Magic Fingers Allison.
She's fast.
Yeah. She's not good with gas.
Or paint.
Or crafts.
Or crafts.
But we're making fun of Allison. She's totally ignoring us here.
Or a Tide Stick, really.
She does have
look at her concentration.
Yeah. It was the Morgan County thing that threw her, Lori. She was almost there and ahead Morgan County.
Did you find it?
I want to make sure it is Martinsville, Indiana. It looks like All Star Pros. It's a place to go. Martinsville All Stars Pros.com. It says they're inexpensive radon testing place. So
great,
Allison, you're amazing.
How about that? She was quick.
Hey, that takes care of it. Thank you so much.
You
trusted
betcha.
From local professionals,
right there. Yeah.
Tell them Allison sent you. Don't ask who.
You better make sure that place is still open.
Yeah, at least Allison did.
Make sure that
here's
it's
what
open.
You do. You take a little cup of gasoline.
click here for a free estimate in seconds.
Okay, so it works.
I think Lori hung
it
up
just wants
on
me
us.
To donate $100 to their cause. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
There we go.
Everyone. All-Star Pros.
Lori,
let us know.
If you're still listening, the way they measure that is in what they call picocuries per liter. And the standard has gradually gone up from about 15.
She's hung
15.
Up.
She's listening. There's a 20-second delay.
I don't know if she cares about the Perco.
She's on allstarspros.com.
I want to give her something so that they don't instill her with fear, okay? So if it's below a certain level, you really can dismiss it a little bit. If it's above a certain level of the picocuries per liter, it really does cause lung cancer, so you got to pay attention. But don't let them spook you out. Make sure that they show you what the scale is and why they are choosing that scale for the measurement. Now, are you ladies done with me?
I'm done. Allison?
Allison.
I'm moving on.
Allison says you can put gasoline in your shoes and lay them out, and if they start to inflame, then you've got radon. It's the Home and Garden Show.
Well, that's
239-939. When we come back, we've got Gary, regular Jeff, and maybe even Charles here on the Home and Garden Show, 93 WIBC. Boy, the email is really hot, and we took a couple calls. Landon Coons on the board took a caller and wanted to know about the Asian jumping worm. Now, I have never heard of an Asian jumping worm.
I don't like it if it's jumping and it's a worm.
But my good buddy Jack Phipps from Allisonville Home and Garden by Sullivan. All right, Jack, what's going on with the Asian jumping worm?
Well, I think it's something that's still kind of coming to the scene. A lot of people are just starting to learn about these little worms, but it's an invasive earthworm that's a little smaller than our, what, the European nightcrawler, that big worm we're used to seeing outside. But these worms can replicate on their own. They don't need, you know, a partner. They don't need that sexual reproduction.
That's pretty amazing.
They tend to eat food a lot quicker, and it says they will still leave those casings or the droppings that have the nutrients and therefore the plants, but they tend to set on the surface of the soil.
Is that the one?
Soil.
Is this the one that pulls the nutrients from the soil and destroys or not somewhat sterilizes the soil for anything else?
Is that pulling it out while it eats, and then the droppings remain on the top? They don't go down in the soil where like the night crawlers leave their droppings.
Are they in Indiana?
They are, yeah.
Well, what do you do to treat? I've never heard of them. Do you treat the soil? What do you do?
So it says you can treat the soil. I think really the biggest was bagging and destroying. They even said euthanizing the worms if you see them.
How do you do that? With a shot?
With a shot?
Yeah, I think it's more of a physical, mechanical means. Yeah.
They call that euthanizing the worm.
That's hilarious.
That is funny.
Wow.
But we picked
just
that word.
Just squish it.
But it said it can quickly strip that top layer of soil where most of those native plants in Indiana need that layer
of soil.
It's the
micronutrients. You know,
yeah,
everything
to germinate.
From actomycetes to all those little things in there that really break down the, you know, the vegetation, the dead organic stuff. Dang.
And they're in Indiana. Did you say yes, they're in Indiana?
They are.
Every year we get one. We got the spotted lantern fly. We've got all these. Once a week
invasives.
Or once a year, we get a new one.
The thing to look out for that jumping worm, it said coffee ground soil. So if it looks like you have coffee grounds, really granular soil at the top, it's all worm droppings and it's all.
All right. So is there a chemical treatment or you're just hammering them? You just stomp on them? What do you do?
Yeah, it doesn't seem like there's a chemical. It said there were studies for promising treatments down the road, but it seems, you know, they don't have a way to separate, differentiate one good worm from a bad worm.
I wonder if they're good fishing worms.
Oh.
Well, said they weren't as slimy as a night crawler.
Well,
maybe.
Then here's the thing, Terry.
That's another way to euthanize them.
You're going to sterilize the fish that eat them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's making the world go round, right?
It is. In
Terry,
a way.
I can't maybe figure I you out. I try to figure you out, but you're a blank slate to me sometimes.
Really?
Yeah, really. Really, really. Let's see how good you do with this septic cleanup. Gary, welcome to the Home and Garden Show. This is called Stump Terry with a cleanup.
No. Oh, gosh, no. Oh, there you go. That's the one with, you know, dun, 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 dun. That's the one with not the E.T., but that was the other.
Paul?
No, it's not Paul. It's the other one.
Yep. Aliens?
No, the other one.
Oh, it was Close Encounters of the
Close Encounters.
Kind.
Right. Yeah. And where was a lot of that? What was it about? It was about where in this world? Muncie, Indiana,
communication,
right?
Communication through music.
It was
all right, Gary. My screen says you want to talk about a septic cleanout. Now we're talking about movie history.
I think that's fun.
Yeah, movie history and septic.
Yeah,
that's our show.
That's right.
Paul was not one of them. Paul was good. Paul got good Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah.
Anyway, about my sewer, Danny, you and I talked about 3 weeks ago about it. Yeah. The previous homeowners had cut it down to the ground level and covered it in paving stones.
God bless them. You found it.
We, $3,000 later, we found it, yes.
Why would somebody do that? It has to be ignorance, Gary, that you see a clean-out plug and you're just going to cut it off?
They're the only house on the entire block that had that happen.
Well,
did we win the lottery on that one?
Yeah, I'm sorry. One of my favorite sayings is
follow up with it. Let you hear the wonderful story and tell folks if you're looking for a home, please make sure the clean out is visible
before you buy it.
Yes.
Yeah, Gary. One of my favorite things to say is that you can't fix stupid. You can fix ignorance, but that is just stupidity. And I'm sorry, but $3,000.
They took the short bus.
I went to school with a lot of kids like that. Gary, thanks for your phone call. All right, we've got, somebody wants to talk about UFOs. Jeff, how are you?
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy. we got regular Jeff. I see who this is.
I don't know how you got on this subject, but I'm going to be honest with you.
Okay, so let's think about this in layman's terms. I've been listening to the station when Bart Bell came on, and then George Norrie does your Coast to Coast every night, all night, while you're sleeping. And I listen to it all. So listen, as far as the aliens or anything out there, remember that the greatest deceiver... Now, you believe in good and evil, right, Denny?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what would be the great deception from the one that was cast out of heaven? And that would be...
Are we talking politicians, or what are we talking here?
No. Politicians, I'm just talking about in the worldview of actually why we're here on Earth. So if you think about this for a second, the greatest deception would be lying and the deception. I do not believe there are any aliens out here, and I've listened to the station for years. You've known that. And to all everyone else, so I can gather information, there is no aliens. There was us created by God, and through Jesus Christ, it's how we get to heaven. So look, I'm stepping out on a limb here. But you did it first.
No. Here's where I just believe that same loving God could create life forms on other planets too. And beyond that, this is the Home and Garden Show, brother. We're just having fun. Okay.
<We're> not really.
All right. But I guess I dumped into that
Thank you, Jeff.
Yeah. Thanks. All right. Let's talk to Robert. Robert's got a dog in his flower bed. Robert.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah. It's all you, buddy. What's going on with your dog?
Well, I found a flower bed for my wife, and he likes to dig it up and lay in it.
Does he like your wife?
Yeah, he likes her, too.
He likes her, too. Okay, we had to clear the deck on that.
Yeah.
Okay, what is he? Is he digging down deep? Is he after a smell? Because there's a way to deal with this, but, you know, what's
he's just digging a place to lay.
He's digging a place to lay.
Nice.
Have you ever thought about using a cage?
Yeah. I'd get him another place to go. Beyond that, there are sprays that you can do.
Like a little animal repellent, fake urine.
Yeah.
Okay. He's got the run of the farm, so he doesn't have to lay there.
Yeah.
That's usually how it goes.
Isn't that funny? It's probably why the dirt was the softest there. Can you make him another bed someplace else and... shade someplace?
A decoy bed?
Yeah.
He's got other beds he's made around, but those are the ones that annoy me.
Those are the ones that annoy me. I'm sorry.
He's digging the flowers up.
Oh, man.
Do you have any ideas, Terry?
No, I don't. It sounds like you said you're on a farm.
Yes.
And he likes this particular spot,
and
right?
And you're sure he likes your wife?
Yes.
Okay. And likes a wife.
Okay.
He likes everybody.
Love that. But I bet any kind of maybe those animal repellents you're talking about, some of those repellents you're talking about, maybe to just, and it won't harm the dog, right?
No,
smell bad to him.
It's going to have to be something bad. Yeah. To scare a dog away, see if you can find something like bear urine or panther urine. It's going to have to be something bigger than the dog. Dog's got pretty powerful urine, and he thinks he's the king of the roost. Good luck, Robert. You can tell we don't have a clue.
One other thing real quick.
Yeah.
You had a lady that was having trees come up in her yard.
Yeah, locust trees. Locust sprouts.
If she cuts them off and puts Torridon on them, Torridon will kill them.
What is Thordon?
I've got the can right here because that's what I'm doing right now, cutting fence row. It's Tordon.
Torridon. Thank you very much. Torridon. We'll look that one up.
Herbicide.
You can get it at farm stores usually. TSC doesn't carry it, but the Rural King does. So.
Okay.
Perfect.
Thanks for the help, man. Our listeners are the best, are they not?
Mm-hmm.
I've never heard of Torridon, but all of you remember now, if you end up at Rural King and you pick up a can of Torridon, the label is the law. Don't get creative with that. Follow the directions and everything should work out. Torridon, have you ever heard of it?
I have not, but it's in my list now.
It's in your list now. It's the Home and Garden Show. Coming back, we'll take your phone calls, 317-239-9393, right here on 93 WIBC. Thanks for tuning in to the Home and Garden Show. We gave you a lot of different real estate there to plow into. Everything from UFOs to Asian jumping worms.
To Tordon.
To Tordon. I'm really glad to hear about that. Yeah. You know, those sprouts drive everybody crazy. So
a tree runner is a hard thing to take care of.
317-239-9393 if you want to get on board with us. We'll take your phone calls. We'll help you in any way we can. Terry Stacy is still with us here. Allison Lemons is still in the studio. Jack has not quit or left.
God bless him. And he will be back again next week because Pat goodness. Is again still on vacation.
Boy, who gave him that? Does he have all that comp time that he
gets
off?
I think he just, his wife was like, we need a vacation. How do you make Pat? You trap him on a boat.
Oh, you trap him? Yeah. That works.
So I hope they're having a great time. We definitely miss Pat, but super glad Jack is with us.
Yeah, it's sort of like that, you know, Stockholm Syndrome, you know, where you appreciate your abuser.
You don't know what you got till it's gone.
Yeah, that's Pat Sullivan and Denny Smith. Hey, let's talk to Steve. Hey, Steve, how are you?
I'm doing well.
Good. What's up, man?
Hey, I'm calling because I think I might have aliens in my garden.
Wow. Oh, man, that's so cool.
This is our kind of call.
Yeah.
And why do you think you have aliens in the garden, Steve?
Well, I work out in the yard. I like the garden, and then I make sure I take care of all the weeds and you know keep the plants nice and green. And but then you know I come back the following day, and then I have like these mysterious tunnels going throughout the area of the garden. And so my first inclination is that maybe it's small aliens.
Actually, those aren't aliens. They're just unidentified. Okay, but okay. Let's. Yeah. Talk.
Are you being politically correct?
I'm trying. I know Jeff's listening here. Yeah. I already got off on
get
that
into
one.
Any of that.
All right, Jack. Things that are jumping below the ground. Certainly, there's moles.
Yeah.
There's gophers.
Chipmunks make.
Chipmunks
runs.
Would do.
Yeah, and mice.
Quite a bit of damage.
Have you seen any evidence of anything in the garden, Steve? Did you see any critters at all?
Yeah, I know I have moles, and I have been trying my best to get rid of those little guys, but they just seem to always make their way back.
Oh, yeah.
Those talpered worms.
Yeah.
Heavy use.
And I bought those poison worms, and I cut them into thirds. I put a hole in the ground in their tunnel and drop them in, and you just never see any results from it, though.
Okay, so why did you use just a third of a worm?
Because a buddy who works at a golf course, he's like, yeah, you can get – you know, more for your mileage if you just cut them up. A third will kill them.
Jack, I'm looking at Jack. Jack, I don't even know what the dosage is.
No.
But that's a golf course guy. He would know.
Yeah. I would think he
yeah.
would.
But he could have a
I would trust
commercial
the golf
grade.
Course. Well, true. Yeah, that may be.
The studio poll says that cutting them in thirds, but I don't know. Talpert is the best way to go because I don't want to harpoon them. I don't want to, the scissor traps cut them in half. Is really pretty
agreed,
gross, Steve. Yeah, so I'd keep. You might want to increase the dosage there. I feel like a pharmacist for a talpered worm here.
Pat's pretty adamant. It has to be an active run, too.
It has to be an active
run. Right?
Yeah.
And that's that
flower
test.
Yeah, I've been trying to pay attention to that. I'll come out and push down the tunnels and then come out and stay, and it's a fresh tunnel. So at that point, I'm baiting it up.
There you go. Well, Steve.
I tell you what, there is nothing better than a cat.
wait a minute. Cats do moles?
Cats do moles. Oh, yes.
I have a barn cat, but he, you know, she's got a brother. His name is Red, and he doesn't really care for the cat.
Well,
so, yeah.
Stop. Don't feed the cat quite as much. The cats get more curious when they're, now Terry's going to give me the stink eye here, but they need to be hungry.
They do need to be hungry, but they also just need to, they just want to catch them. But obviously he's got cats and that's not working out either. So
yeah,
I guess you just have to learn to live with them. I'm sorry. Yeah. Thanks for calling. Yeah. Thanks for calling.
Thank you.
We're hanging up on you now, Steve.
No, we're not hanging up on you.
Boy, Terry, you've got a brutal streak in you sometimes.
Well, she's honest. She's honest.
I'm just saying, cats aren't doing it.
All
worms
right.
aren't doing it.
Ladies and gentlemen, you ready? We've got about a 3-minute segment here. And ladies and gentlemen, one of the smartest self-proclaimed geniuses of all time, Charles.
No, not.
It's all you, Charles. Charles?
Hello?
Charles,
this is going well.
Can you hear that?
Yeah, we hear you now.
Oh, yeah, there we go. Well, make it real quick because I know we get toward the top of the hour. God bless all of you and your families and everybody in Radio Land.
Thank you, Charles.
Just a, yeah. Oh, geez, stop. Yeah, a couple of you. Sorry about how time. Last month was the 77th anniversary of Roswell. There's an entire show going on that one. And, but I think it happened, but that's another story. Two quick alien jokes, and then I've got the greatest movie that already I've been mentioned twice already.
You got 2 minutes.
Okay, I'm going fast. Okay. Flying saucer comes flying down over farmer's field, tears the landing gear off. The saucer crashes. Nobody's hurt. The farmer runs out and waves at the alien and says, do you want us to take me to your leader? He says, no, get us a ladder. We'll go to your leader later.
Oh, boy.
Anyway, it's terrible. Anyway, I got the punch jumped on me. On the,
not your best.
This is the 47th anniversary of two of the greatest movies ever. Star Wars, of course, is 47 years old.
It's amazing.
And Close Encounters, which Terry mentioned, it's the governor and mayor, both Ohio and Indiana, wanted to know where that toll booth was and the Muncie Mountains.
Yeah.
In the film.
True.
But Dreyfus originally was supposed to work for the gas company, and for reasons to this day we don't know, Spielberg was told, we don't want to represent your film, Mr. Spielberg. Of course, he hadn't really caught on big time yet. Jaws had been out, but not to the big time. And so Dreyfus' character was actually a gas company. But you're ready for this. Now, you didn't mention the Indianapolis International is mentioned as one of the UFOs buzzes a plane, which you don't see on screen, of course. But now this is one for everybody. Well, this is why I'm called the self-proclaimed Mr. Know-It-All. You remember the big finale? I don't like to give movies when we still haven't given all away. When the mothership finally arises and it goes from left, REM, not the group, but your eyes are normally patterned from left to right. As the mothership starts in the bottom left-hand corner of the screen, Dreyfus and him over in the bottom right. As she rises from left to right, hit your pause button, because to the top right, and it's a miniature, would only fit in the diameter of a quarter. As an inside joke, is R2-D2. It doesn't move or blink or nothing. It's up in the top right rim of the ship as it comes up to the right side of the screen.
Oh, wow.
And if that's not useless enough, and I know Allison can find it, John Williams, who did all the, you know, done all the Star Wars and Indiana Jones, all the scores, he gave an award to Bill Murray way back when, in 77 or 78. Mm-hmm. That's the only version. You ready for this?
Okay.
The love theme from Close Encounters. So if Allison maybe punch up, but Bill Murray did that on Saturday Night Live.
She's looking.
And it was, yeah, love theme. I'm not making it up. But anyway, yeah, but you'll have to have your, and remember, you're not looking for a giant R2-D2 when the special effects were created. Again, Lucas dared to do it, and it's, you know, but it was priceless when the movie came out, Entertainment Tonight. Never showed the clip because they wanted people to get back in the theater.
There you go. Charles the genius. Man. The only man in Central Indiana.
Charles the genius.
He can breathe through his ears. He never takes a breath.
Nope.
Did you guys hear about the alien who was obsessed with the moon?
No.
It was just a phase.
Hey, do you know who
Charles.
Do you know who my favorite art or my favorite Star Wars character is? L2-D2.
Oh.
Live long, drop dead. You get it? L2-D2, oh, yeah. Live long, drop dead.
Is this thing on?
Thanks for calling, Danny.
I know. I got all my training. I'm an apprentice to Charles the Genius. Okay. All right. Coming up is the speed round.
I think it's ready for it.
Brought to you by Thompson Brothers out of Columbus, if they still believe in us. But we got room for your call. But trust me, we got room for it. 317-239-9393. It's the Home and Garden Show, brought to you by the Michaelis Corporation. Water storms, fire, and wet basements. Life happens. Michaelis happens to help you through it. All right. Boy, after 3 hours and 45 minutes, I'm almost worn out, but I'm ready for the speed round.
What started as whatever Pat says.
Yeah. You're doing good. Take a run at it.
I don't remember what.
What started as bubble art and UFOs is now time for the speed round. Who's ready for the speed round? Who? You can't handle the speed round. The speed round is brought to you by
Thompson Furniture and Mattress in Columbus. Great pricing on Lazy Boy, Indiana-made Smith Brothers Furniture, mattresses made in Indiana, and maintenance-free outdoor furniture. Free delivery up to 75 miles. ThompsonFurniture.net. My thanks to Allison Lemons. That was classic.
That was apologies really to everyone listening.
Oh, no. All right. So the number is 239-9393. 317-239-9393. Get on board. We'll get as many as we can. First up is Donna. Hey, Donna, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. I think I have a previous problem that one of your callers called in just a few minutes ago. I counted at least 9 holes in my flower garden, and they have eaten the hostas.
Yeah,
what is this?
Chipmunks or squirrels, I'm guessing. Yeah, what do you think, Jack?
If you're saying holes, I'm guessing it's a chipmunk going down in there. Typically, you wouldn't see a hole for a mole, would you?
No. They're digging for the roots.
Oh.
Oh, boy. So is it what you might want to try to do, and it's just a temporary fix, but if you've got, do you know what hardware cloth is?
No.
Okay, hardware cloth, it looks like a fence, only it's got quarter-inch squares or half-inch squares. And if you can lay that down just underneath the mulch around the hostas that have not been eaten yet, just sort of cut it and then put a little layer of mulch on top of that. What happens is the little boogers get in there and it hurts their teeth. It you know, they're trying to chew on steel, and they get pretty upset about it and they just leave. Okay, they go over to Allison's.
Yeah, the holes, you can actually put your finger way down.
Yeah, they're pretty. Well, what's happened is some of it is caved in after they got out, but they're ornery. I saw that Jane and I were walking over at Cool Creek Park. And I saw all these little holes, and I'm thinking, what's digging those holes? And then I saw the little chipmunk going after the roots. They try to keep the plants there, right there on the main entrance. But the chipmunks are just, they're death on that. They're just death.
Well, you know, I've never seen one in my yard.
Really?
I've never. No.
Well,
it's in your flower bed.
In my flower bed. Oh, yeah. They've just eaten the hostas.
Just be glad you don't have the Asian jumping worms, sweetie.
Oh, no.
Oh, my gosh. So.
Okay. Will those hostas come back?
They will, yeah, absolutely. They're tough. They may not be as full next spring, but certainly by the end of the summer next year, you should see them popping up, looking much better.
Okay.
Oh, if not, you're doing your part for the retail industry and the garden industry. So
come see us up at Allison.
Yeah, there you go. Donna, thank you for your phone call. You have a great week. All right, kids, next call is Kathy. Hi, Kathy.
Hi.
What's up?
I have a arborvita, I think is the name you pronounce it, evergreen. I actually have 6 of them, and one has, I've replaced it already once. The first one died. Same place, I replaced it, and now my second one is dying. Just in this last 2 weeks, I've noticed it really turning brown. And there's 6 of them around my patio. This just one area, I don't know why it's dying. I don't know whether to fertilize it, to water it more. How can I don't want to replace it.
Yeah, and, first question for you would be, did you plant them yourself?
Yes, we did.
Okay, mm-hmm. And when you took that one out that wasn't doing well, did you break up the soil and the ground, that clay kind of around the base of it before you planted that second one?
I did, yes.
Okay.
And I even put new topsoil in the area, so I had new soil around it.
Okay. So, what you want to make sure you're not doing is digging a hole, just taking that clay out and adding in topsoil to replace.
Okay.
Otherwise, it just creates kind of a basin that tree doesn't learn to grow out of. If you can kind of work in, you know, we say a quarter new soil to 75% original soil, you know, so breaking that into the clay. And then make sure that root ball is not settling below ground level. So, you know, a couple extra handfuls or shovels of dirt at the bottom of that hole before your new one goes in.
So the mound needs to be on top of the ground level?
Yeah, so you just want the top of the root ball a couple inches above ground level so that when you water or it rains and it settles, you know, it's ultimately at ground level, never below.
Okay. All right.
So that would be my guess that it could have settled down a little bit and maybe got a little too wet.
Yeah, Kathy, and for anybody who's ever planted multiple arbs, this is so typical. There's always one black sheep that dies or gives you trouble. And so you replace it and you do everything right and it does exactly the same thing. So you're not cursed. It's just that's the success rate of the plant. But you can blame yourself. Do you got another family member that you don't like that you can blame it on them?
Sure. I
agree
with my husband.
Yeah, it's his fault. I saw him do it, you know. He probably dumps his coffee out there. So.
Yes, exactly.
Kathy, thanks for listening to the show. Thanks for calling in, okay?
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Have a great
Bye-bye.
Week. Wow, have we got a great weekend ahead of us or what?
Yeah.
The circle's alive with a little bit of a fair going on down here. And it's going to be a beautiful weekend. If you get a chance to go out to the Indiana State Fair, this would be a great weekend to do that. Allison, you been to the fair yet?
I haven't been out there yet. Everybody else has, but I've been back in studio, so I need to get out there hopefully next weekend.
Yeah, it's beautiful. Or during the week. Oh, you got to work during the week. I forgot about that.
Field trip next Saturday.
Yeah. $2 Tuesdays. I mean, that you can go on Tuesday. Ooh. Just go early.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. $2 Tuesday.
The food was unbelievable. The folks at the dairy bar really took good care of us with their cheese sandwiches.
Grilled cheese. Oh my
God. So good.
They're peel apart. They got pepperoni. They got this spicy honey that it's got just a little bit of a snap to it, plus three different types of cheeses. I was in love
with it. That was on Terry's shirt.
That was on Terry's shirt.
That same hot honey grilled cheese.
Yeah, that's how we were doing the menu last week. We were looking at the shirts, and finally, you got to be careful with that, Jack. You know,
did you get the blueberry shake?
I got the blueberry shake.
That's so good.
Didn't it go? They're all natural flavors. You know, they're doing it the right way, but they're at the dairy bar. Across the way, they took a donut, and they opened up a donut, which was sort of like a muffin of sorts. They opened it up, and it was glazed all the way around, lots of sugar and stuff. And in the middle, they put barbecue. And you don't think that sounds good?
No, I'd go for that.
It was phenomenal. There are so many things out there. Get to the Indiana State Fair and don't forget WIBC on the weekends right here on 93 WIBC.